chapeau. Je t'emmène voir les expos. Maman te tiendra le bras, hurlant ripipipoura. On mangera des frites et du chocolat. Pour chanter les expos sont là. Quand moi je crierai bravo, toi tu lanceras ton chapeau. On les fera champions nos expos. Ne vois-tu pas qu'il est déjà l'heure d'aller encourager nos couleurs? Car déjà les estrades sont pleines, bleu, blanc, rouge, les voilà qui s'amènent. Viens, papa, fais-toi beau, mets ton joli chapeau, je t'emmène voir les expos. Maman te tiendra le bras, hurlant et pipipoura. On mangera des frites et du chocolat. Viens, papa, dépêche-toi. On n'attend plus que toi pour chanter les expos sont là. Quand moi je crierai bravo, toi tu lanceras ton chapeau. On les fera champions nos expos. On les fera champions nos expos. Le bras, hurlant ripipipoura, on mangera des frites et du chocolat. Viens, papa, dépêche-toi, on n'attend plus que toi pour chanter les expos sont là. Quand moi je crierai bravo, toi tu lanceras ton chapeau, on les fera champions nos expos. Ne vois-tu pas qu'il est déjà l'heure d'aller encourager nos couleurs? Car déjà les estrades sont pleines, bleu, blanc, rouge, les voilà qui s'amènent. Viens, papa, fais-toi beau, mets ton joli chapeau, je t'emmène voir les expos. Maman te tiendra le bras, hurlant et pipipoura. On mangera des frites et du chocolat. Viens, papa, dépêche-toi. On n'attend plus que toi pour chanter les expos sont là. Quand moi je crierai bravo, toi tu danseras ton chapeau. On les fera champions nos expos. On n'est pas champions aux expos. Viens, papa, fais-toi beau, mets ton joli chapeau, je t'emmène voir les expos. Maman te tiendra le bras, hurlant ripipipoura, on mangera des frites et du chocolat. Pour chanter les expos sont là. Quand moi je crierai bravo, toi tu lanceras ton chapeau. On les fera champions nos expos. Ne vois-tu pas qu'il est déjà l'heure d'aller encourager nos couleurs? Car déjà les estrades sont pleines, bleu, blanc, rouge, les voilà qui s'amènent. Viens, papa, fais-toi beau, mets ton joli chapeau, je t'emmène voir les expos. Maman te tiendra le bras.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Monastery, the world's greatest shit show, the late and fig episode, and the place where we, the good brothers and sisters of this holy of temples, try and seek enlightenment through the drunkest, craziest, most batshit way possible in the open bar of the internet. I am, as always, your one and only gaming monk, better known as Mildra, and with me I have two of my good brothers. We have the flamboyant flyer himself, good brother Flutter, and we have the person who knows how to run the ball, unlike fucking Nagy, and the man who could probably run the Blackhawks better than Stan Bowman, the bane of NPCs, good brother Aaron. How the fuck are we doing tonight?
Good.
I swear to God, if it was me that owned the fucking Bears, I'd be going down to that fucking locker room at halftime. I'd be going into full Gordon Ramsay mode and be shouting at Nagy, "Get out, you donkey!"
And you know what? I see we got a fair amount of people in the chat, and yeah, I decided to change up the opening this time around because we need to celebrate another ending of a legacy of failure.
Thank God you did not play Baby Shark.
No. I had to hear an orchestra play Baby Shark. I've had my fill. Thank you very much.
Oh, God. Because, like I said, anybody plays fucking Baby Shark in my presence is going to get stabbed in the eyes.
Yep, and Dr. No, yeah, OBS has not exactly been kind. I still can't get my soundboard to work. I might have to start from scratch, worst case scenario.
Well, that's all right. I think I got you covered on the I'll get that salt clip though.
All right. Hang on.
Yeah, just pass me the salt clip.
Right.
But yeah, but as for Nagy, well, I can't really banish him to Detroit. Because I don't want him wrecking another halfway decent team. But let's see here. I have a better idea. Here we go.
Okay, lay it on me.
Hold on a second. I'm preparing it. Here we go. This is what I would do.
Put them in the Iron Maiden.
Iron Maiden? Excellent!
Execute them.
Oh, yes.
Yep.
As far as Halloween, mine went pretty well. I managed to expose a whole new audience to groups like Ghost, which is always a plus. Mm-hmm. And a bit of power level. And I see Eggsy, if you're going with Savage Worlds, good call. Savage Worlds is a good system. The Match of Monsters review didn't get quite the traction that I had hoped. So I think it's a sign that maybe doing games in that style isn't the best move.
Hmm.
So anyone who's looking for a follow-up to Pokemon Tabletop United, you're going to be waiting for a little while.
Yeah.
Now, as far as what's coming next, I will probably do the... you'll probably see the thing that Xanatrix had asked me to do a while back. I just didn't have it in the schedule at the time.
Ah.
Yeah.
Plus, it gives me the perfect opportunity to use an old gag from the tabletop show.
Mm-hmm.
For those of you who missed it, on Friday, I hosted a little watch party of Vampire Hunter D Bloodlust.
I thought that was Thursday, not Friday.
Yeah, it was Thursday. Yeah.
And you should have been there, Aaron.
I was working.
Yeah, no worries. As far as the BlizzCon thing, we will get to that later, so spoiler. But
yeah.
Let's start with a bit of grifting. So,
yeah.
ODB's Indiegogo is currently at 15.2 thousand, still a long ways to go. And and fortunately, we found out that the next couple tapings for Impact, the ticket sales for that are going to go towards ODB's Indiegogo.
Right.
Which is something I very much appreciate.
Yeah.
And yeah, I did put up a few that I could. Somebody so I could help out in what way I could.
Right.
But hopefully she manages to get close to 50K by the time this ends.
Yeah.
Although apparently it'll receive all funds raised even if it doesn't reach its funding goals. So there is the possibility that she might still be able to recover even if it doesn't get to 50K.
Yeah. Because of that, yeah.
But it's not going to be cheap because you've seen what was left of the thing. The thing got
trashed. Ooh. Yeah.
Yeah, you need a new fucking truck.
Mm-hmm.
But let's start off with the Kickstarter spotlight. So, the first one that we have is coming to us from Sydney. Dark Stars, a cyberpunk in space RPG that is currently asking for about 13,800. It's managed to beat its goal with 10 days left.
Yeah, they beat their $20,000 dues goal.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
And this is Morgan Lean's second Kickstarter.
Hmm.
He wants to do a cyberpunk RPG set in space. Interesting approach. Where he has cybered up anarchists and gritty soldiers of fortune fighting corporations across human colonies and the Outer Rim.
Mm-hmm.
I do like this sort of mega city approach that we have on the cover.
Yeah.
He's raising funds to print off rule books, scenario books, and to fund more artwork and develop two more expansion books.
Nice.
Mm-hmm.
So apparently he made the system, he made the game because he wanted something that could handle vehicle combat, hacking, and personal combat in one system.
Mm-hmm.
I can definitely say he's got the cyberpunk aesthetic right with the art style.
Yeah.
But some of the packages that he's asking for, like, let's see, the top one is at about 615. Might be asking a bit much there, mate.
Yeah.
But it's managed to work.
Mm-hmm.
And I get the feeling that he's had this idea kicking around for a while. And Doku, get the fuck in here!
Wait a minute, is he in the chat?
Yes, he is.
Yep.
God damn it, get out of here!
Oh.
Get your Washington ass in here, Doku. So, I'd say for Dark Stars, he certainly earned meeting his goal and exceeding it. So, next we have Mystic Lilies, a rules-light tabletop role-playing game about vengeful witches and dark manipulation. It's coming to us from Princeton. He was only asking for 2,000. He's currently at 2,500 and change, with 26 days to go.
Oh, nice. Yeah.
Let's see here. Social oh, and already there's a red flag.
Let's see. Okay, it's inspired by Monster Hearts, Toho Project, Bayonetta, and Madoka Magica. It's interesting that they're using a suit of cards thing, which I like.
Okay.
Let's see. Collaborative drama, a game about social conflict.
Yeah,
Characters are made to cause drama. I'm perfectly fine with that.
Yeah, a couple things that got me sniffing, but nothing too egregious.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Let's see. Rewards. Now, hopefully... let's see. Yeah, I'm not seeing too much that would spark a red flag. And given that he's admitting that Bayonetta is an inspiration, it's probably not gonna be too much.
Wait and see.
And Doku's trying to weasel out by bringing up the Caps game. I'm like, get your ass in here, anyways.
The Nats won. No excuse. Nats won a World Series. No excuse.
Do it.
Okay.
It's like there are three constants in life: death, taxes, and us yelling at Doku. All right, so the next one we have is The Ruin, a post-apocalyptic role-playing game, which...
I don't know if it's just me. Hold up. I don't know if it's just me, but did they rip this artwork out of Fallout?
No. I think that's just you.
Because that artwork reminds me of of the Pit DLC from Fallout 3.
That's not the vibe I'm getting. I'm getting Mutant Year Zero. All right, so apparently what he wants to do is both use the D20 system as well as the original percentile system he made for the game. If I end up backing this, which it's looking interesting, I think you can guess which version I'm going with, and geez, that's an ugly-ass rat.
Yeah, really. Hey, Doku.
Yeah, give me 10 fucking minutes, dude. I'm at the fucking bar watching the fucking Caps game. I had to get the fuck out of the house.
I didn't know, man. How was I supposed to know that?
I said it in the fucking chat, damn it. I'll be there in like fucking 10 minutes. Jesus you Christ, said... give me a fucking minute. And yeah, once I actually fucking get there, you'll fucking listen to me actually want to have... it. Yeah, I know I rant and shit. Yeah, expect me to go on a fucking hell of a rant tonight because I'm in a pissed off mood. Halloween sucked. Fuck the Nats.
Well,
oof. Tell us how you really feel.
I'll tell you how I really feel when I get the fuck back home and this motherfucker, fuck your Audi! Yeah, wait for it. It'll be a fucking fun goddamn time. I hope you have fucking beers ready because it's gonna be a fucking one hell of a goddamn time. We always have beers ready. Yeah, it's gonna be a fun fucking night, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you're fucking ready for it. Also, by the way, drink. I don't give a fuck about your tank ball or your fucking skull. Drink already. Let's get started proper. Fuck Halloween, fuck the Nats, fuck Kobe Bryant, and fuck everybody else that fucking kneels for the national anthem. If you don't like it, suck my dick.
What's your beef with Kobe? If you mean LeBron James, then I can understand.
He's gone. He'll probably be back in a bit. So, moving on to the next one. So next we have Aeolus. A a kingdom building game that is very clearly inspired by Civilization. Apparently it's coming to us from Braunschweig, Germany, which probably explains why it took some Civ aspects. And it seems to be very Greek.
Oh, very Greek, yep.
And I do appreciate that they did a family version of the pledge where you could get art that's not going to be, because some of the art might not be family friendly. Which I appreciate that they did an option instead of having it be mandatory. But I'm starting to see the Civilization comparison. Especially since you have to build up resources to workers in order to start building shit.
Oh damn! No wonder they created a kiddie version. Damn! Look at that artwork. Mm-hmm. You know what? Screw calling it a family version. You know what I would call it? The triggered version. Just in case these idiots start squealing about tits.
Yep. I do like the merchant template that they have with this rotating thing that would seem to indicate a shifting economy. As well as the possibility of manipulating the market. Looks like we also have a degree of a tech tree with the philosopher of the academy. And the hoplite of the arena, obviously being the military approach. But yeah, the vibe that I get out of this is the game that Imperator Rome should have been. Even though this is Greece.
Yeah, not only that, it reminds me of Clash of the Titans.
Which I'm gonna end up saying something that's gonna get me some shit, but I think the original Clash of the Titans is not Harryhausen's best work.
Oh, okay.
I think Argonauts is a better film.
Oh, okay. Yeah. That's a fair point. Let's see here. Board Game Geek, they can die in a fire.
Oh, did you see some of the one-star reviews that Virtue Signal got on Board Game Geek?
Oh, yeah!
They tried to ratio it and they still failed.
Oh, my God. Hey, Mildred, can you give me the salt clip? Because I want to play that.
Yeah, give me a second. I will DM that to you.
Yeah. Because that is apropos.
All right. Hang on. So, message. he goes, you all are fucking slacking it. Look. Okay, there you go.
All right. Here you go. I'll just download it onto my thing. This should take like 2 seconds. Yeah, because this is definitely apropos. There you go.
The shit show was smug. No, I did not see that.
Down here, salt is a way of life.
Obviously, the environment down here is all salt. The ceiling's salt, the floor is salt, the walls are salt, and to an extent, the air is salt. And you breathe that in, and you can constantly taste the salt.
All right. So our last one of the Kickstarter spotlights tonight is Vertebreaker, which leads me to wonder if Shane Helms is doing is involved with this.
Probably is.
But they're asking for $275,000. Holy shit!
I don't know, man.
Coming to us from Riverside, California, that might be a bit much. Now they do have a demo. Apparently, this is being created by Headcanon, who has worked on the mobile versions of Sonic 1 and 2, as well as Sonic Mania.
Yeah, well, they got something behind it. So the question is, I understand. This has been a problem with video game Kickstarters as of late. They have set high goals that they probably will never attain. But the thing here is, the only reason they set those high goals is because, as I talked to Flutter early before the show, that it because of the Western industry has turned into such a clusterfuck. Games are so fucking hard, expensive to make, and B, it's leveraged out the ass. So they're pretty much caught between a rock and a hard place. I say yes, what they're asking is a little ambitious, but at the same time, you really can't blame them.
When it comes to this particular situation, I think what's going on. What's going on with my mouse? Okay, there we go. So, I think what's going on is that there is a bit of overconfidence in the fact that they're doing this from the same team that did Sonic Plus. But another problem I'm having now, they've got a demo, and they've certainly got some art that is very, it's very much evoking old school Genesis, and game development isn't. It's certainly not cheap, but I wouldn't say it's that expensive.
Mm-hmm.
Apparently, their argument is, as far as why they need that much, is because they're starting a brand new game with a brand new IP from scratch. And having no capital with which to fund further development, and would rather bring it directly to you.
Again, understandable, but like I said, you know how the gaming industry is. Like I said,
I know where you're about to go with that, but I don't think that applies.
Right.
Well, if it's 16-bit, if it's using 16-bit graphics, that's a whole nother story.
It is.
Which is why this doesn't apply. Which is why that doesn't apply to this.
Yeah.
But yeah. It'll be a miracle if they get almost $300,000 in a month.
Yeah, no shit.
Although, the game that this reminds me of, honestly, is Rystar. More than Sonic.
Oh, it's Rystar.
I can see it.
Okay, with a little bit, but I don't think Freedom Planet managed to come out fine.
Yeah,
but I am liking the potential of what I'm seeing with this, and I do, and despite me balking at that amount they're asking for, I do hope they manage to reach their goal, and they've got a good amount of time left.
Yeah,
I think having a demo out is certainly going to help.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah. Now, like I said, what also can help, they need to start going around the circuit and start pushing, shilling this shit like a motherfucker.
Yeah, networking is a necessity for something like this.
Yeah, if you're setting almost a little over $250,000, you better fucking pound that pavement, go shill.
Yeah.
Best of luck, Headcanon. You're gonna need it.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm. So next we have the fact that, so getting into the news. So this coming to us from Nichibon, World End Economica is getting an anime. Now, apparently the anime project is going to be crowdfunding, with a crowdfund launching November 14th, with some further details coming then. Now, World End Economica is a visual novel set on the moon, and obviously dealing with business. It is currently available on Steam. It'll be coming to consoles and the PS Vita, of all things, sometime this winter.
Sounds like Wall Street Kid in Space.
I'll
you remember that game?
Yeah, I remember. But I don't think that I get the feeling this is going to be more akin to See the Money of Soul.
Oh.
Ah.
Right. So next. You know, I thought it was done talking about legal bullshit regarding D&D.
It never ends.
Well, this is a different case. This is a long-running issue that's been resolved.
Mm-hmm.
So, earlier this week, Tom DeSanto, the producer of X-Men and Transformers, dismissed a lawsuit against Gail Gygax.
He said to back away from Gail Gygax.
Who, as you recall, she tried to do that whole I want people to write about D&D, but only the pre-approved kind of people.
Oh.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The lawsuit is over a deal that was struck in 2016 between DeSanto and Gail, which would allow DeSanto to become D&D's guardian of the library and develop projects based on Gygax's own particular IP, like the Castle of Zagig.
Yeah.
But in May 2017,
mm-hmm.
The suit ended up reading that he learned that Gygax had a second will. He wrote it shortly before his death. That will, accordingly, merely gives Gail a life estate to some of Gary's IP, the parts his children couldn't claim. That would mean that when Gail dies, DeSanto would no longer have the rights to develop Gygax properties, making their contract worthless. Apparently, the reason this lawsuit happened was due to Gail trying to negotiate a video game deal without DeSanto's participation.
Oh.
Fortunately, the whole thing was dismissed without prejudice. And the interest in the estate he negotiated for is still on the record. And of course, this is shortly after that news that Wizards of the Coast will be working on some new digital games for D&D.
Oh boy!
Oh god!
Fucking so, WotC.
Yeah.
Yep.
So as far as how this is gonna go. I don't think anything's really going to come of this. It just seems like a couple of cases where there's no winners due to. Why the hell do you need two wills like that?
Yeah.
I
could understand why he would have two wills. Guy's a little paranoid about his fucking IP being misused.
I'm guessing he's still paranoid about what happened with the Bloom brothers when he had them take the reins.
Oh yeah.
And if you're thinking that has anything to do with WotC, no. That was back in the 80s when TSR was still around. He went off to California to try and push for a film and a TV series about his IP. While the Bloom brothers ended up fucking up so hard that he had to go back to Wisconsin to tell them to knock it the hell off, and was about to fire them, and then they sold their share to Lorraine Williams.
Oh, fuck Williams.
Yeah.
Who nobody in TSR likes.
Yeah, so they had nothing to do with them, but you know what? the road to hell was first paid by those guys.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, incidentally, Can I just state once again how it blows my mind that the Orville managed to be a better Star Trek than Star Trek? More specifically, Star Trek Discovery.
And the best part is, no fucking lawsuits.
Yeah.
Although I'm no fan of fucking McFarlane, the guy's a.
I don't like him, and I don't care for Family Guy, but I'm going to give the devil its due.
Yeah.
And they have started principal photography for season 3. Especially right after a panel at New York Comic Con.
Ah.
The panel had most of the cast except for Seth. I don't know why.
Yeah.
And even better, and this is a case of who could have seen this coming. Jonathan Frakes wants to make an appearance on an episode.
Oh yeah, I heard about that.
That is a huge flex.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's actually going to happen, but since they're starting principal photography, it's early enough where it could.
I say do it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Show up these freaking pretenders.
Yeah.
I gave Discovery its chance. It blew it.
Yep.
And that's not me. I'm not saying that just because of the lawsuit. I'm saying that because I don't think I don't think whoever's writing Discovery got what they were doing.
Right.
Of course not.
Yep. So next. So Netflix is dipping into anime again, and this time with a wholly self-produced thing. This is being produced from top to bottom by Netflix instead of just buying the streaming rights for a show.
Yeah.
The particular show is called Eden. It is being directed by Yasuhiro Irie, who was the director for Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood.
Ah!
And it does look like we're doing the whole post-apocalypse, and I'm pretty sure somebody's going to make some comparisons to Nier.
Mm-hmm.
So apparently what we have is a kid who is the last human.
Oh boy, but like I said, it going on Netflix, it doesn't sound hopeful. I'm sorry.
That said, it does have a bit of a Ghibli feel to it.
Oh yeah, definitely.
And while I'm normally hesitant about CG anime because the animation tends to be a little rough for this series, and maybe it's because they're doing a mini series and not a full series. It's looking a lot smoother.
Mm-hmm.
So apparently, it's going to be coming out sometime in 2020.
See.
So next, now this is something that I covered a while back, but I'm doing a bit of a follow-up. So Azure Flame Studios is doing an open beta test for an English translation for Banner of the Maid.
Ah.
Mm-hmm.
It is an interesting turn-based strategy that we managed to find a while back that has plenty of waifu content. The only issue is the fact that it wasn't translated. But if it's getting an English translation, I might dip my toe into that.
Oh right. Boy. Some tells me two certainties about this one. Someone's gonna try to put some nudity in this, number one. Number two, the usual woke jagoffs are gonna be pissy.
Yeah.
Yeah, but if it's just reset error, I don't care. They're too busy getting mad about boob plate for Hilda. So next we have Mecha Knights, and if you listen close, you can hear Misanthropic yelling in the distance.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway.
So, and what's more impressive, this game is a one-man show.
I think we talked about that, didn't we?
Not this one. I only found out about
because there was another game that was a one man show a while back.
That was that was last week.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. This is being developed by a Polish guy named Damian Kubiak. Hopefully, I got that right. It was recently put on.
It's Kubiak. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It has a Steam page. So we're doing a mech action game where you have a mech against hordes of blank. Should have fixed that with your edit. Should have run that by your editor there, Giuseppe.
Yeah.
Oh, you know what this reminds me of?
Shoot.
God, what's that game that Razorfist likes to play? That mech game that Razorfist likes to play.
Mech Warrior?
No. Something else. Not Mech Warrior, not BattleTech, no. I think it's a Japanese game. Not the best optimized in the world, but you play as a mech going after like a bunch of aliens and shit.
Yeah, that doesn't narrow it down all that much, and I don't watch his arcade streams. Plus,
right.
For various reasons. Apparently, he cites his inspirations as Armored Core, Front Mission, EDF, Resident Evil, Blue Gender, and Muv Love.
Nice.
Oh, wait a minute. EDF, that's it.
Yeah.
And we've got a bit of footage going for us. And I am definitely seeing the Armored Core vibes here. And yes, Al, the Earth Defense Force.
Yeah, he loves that game.
Which is surprising because he seems to have a hate boner for anything not 80s.
Can't say I blame him.
I can because I don't stand for nostalgia tars, and you don't see me playing 80s D&D, do you?
Yeah, point taken.
Yeah.
You want me to bring back Thaco? I can bring back Thaco.
Fossa era Shadowrun.
I can definitely say that the mech design here has a good start as far as DACA, but not quite enough.
Yep.
Yeah.
But it looks like they're doing a fair amount of mech customization.
Mm-hmm.
It does look. I have to wonder if the leg plating means that you could do some degree of charging. It's probably not going to have much in the way of melee because Armored Core games didn't have much in the way of melee.
Right.
It's definitely going to be wave based. There's probably not going to be a huge amount of story because this is, again, just a one-man show.
Mm-hmm.
But the only problem that I'm having with this currently, zoom the camera back a little bit. It is way too close to the mech, in my opinion.
Yeah. Stay
close up!
Yeah, I agree.
Let's see. Apparently, his planned release date is autumn 2020. Well, he's got something nice here. So next, Lost Wing is going to be at EGX Berlin.
Hmm.
According to Tim Ash, who is the director at Box Frogs Game, the developers of the game, and. Let's take a look at what we're dealing with Lost Wing. Oh, it really is a box frog. And I see what we've got here. I will always have a soft spot for rail shooters, and it looks like this is one that is heavily based on speed and a degree of platforming.
I remember. You know what this game reminds me of?
Shoot.
Anyone play Hyperzone back in the day?
I did.
Yeah, this is like Rising of Hyperzone, except a lot better.
I could easily see this game getting some love from speedrunners.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Especially those who like to do perfection challenges.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
So next, there was an overview trailer put out for Marvel's Avengers, and I have mixed feelings about some parts of it.
All right, let's see.
All right. Moving into a bit. And yeah, I don't particularly care for their decision as to why they chose Kamala as a central character. But if they can somehow redeem her, I'll give them their due.
Yeah, if they're using, like I said, if they use Paulo Romero's version of Kamala Khan, then they'll get a pass.
I'm not entirely sure about this whole gear system that they have here. It feels like this could be
skill tree.
The skill tree, yeah. I don't have a problem with. It's the gear thing that I have a bit of an issue with, especially since that might limit the amount of
leveling
potential characters.
For leveling items, I see.
Yeah.
Hmm.
Because when you're doing both loot based gear and an upgrade tree like this.
Bold strategy, Cotton. We'll see if that pays off.
The main issue that I'm gonna have with this sort of thing is because of that approach, it's probably going to limit how many characters they can put in.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And no matter what, people are going to compare this game to Ultimate Alliance 3, and I'm not sure if it's going to be able to match up.
I see.
Yeah, sounds like an Ultimate Alliance clone. Like I said, old strategy, Cotton. Let's see if this plays out.
It'll probably pay out better than Marvel Online did.
Yeah.
So next, Conglomerate 451 has been delayed, which is describing itself as a cyberpunk dungeon crawler. And
interesting.
The vibe I get out of this is like a cyberpunk version of say a Bard's Tale or Wizardry, that sort of old school CRPG.
Mm-hmm.
Or for a more recent example, Mary Skelter.
Oh, this looks nice. It's sort of like reminds me of it's basically like fucking cyberpunk version of Grimrock or fucking Dungeon Master or some shit like that.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
Fuck. I say go ahead and delay it. You're gonna need this is a good concept. And you best get it the first time.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't blame him for delaying it.
Yeah, neither do I.
Let's see,
but the bad news here.
What's that?
The bad news here. They delayed it to February. Dangerously close to Cyberpunk 2077.
Even if they're not playing the same way, that might cause problems because I can guarantee you, even despite our issues with Randy Pitchford, I think Battleborn could have carved out a niche for itself if it didn't release around the same time as Overwatch.
Yeah.
Because and regardless don't get me wrong, of the fact that the two games aren't the same, people are going to compare them.
Yeah, and not only that, yeah, Conglomerate 451, the creators, it's not a AAA title, technically. But, and this got a lot of potential. I mean, yeah, it could be seen by many as like an appetizer for Cyberpunk 2077, but releasing it, I understand the delay, but releasing it dangerously close to it.
Well, let me clarify. The game has been out on early access since May.
Okay.
So I don't think it's going to fuck them over as much.
Yeah.
Okay.
So next, you know how we talked about Freedom Planet earlier? Well, Freedom Planet's getting a sequel.
Huh.
Which looks like they're doing a full-on adventure mode that, and this particular adventure mode is going to be expanding the roster a little.
Ah.
Which I am perfectly fine with. Apparently, they're also doing a classic mode, which is basically the same game, just with the cutscenes removed. As well as a branching path setup, so it'll be nice to see how this works out.
Yeah.
And doing the "Are you a bad enough dude?" Yeah, I think there's something here.
Mm-hmm.
Including doing some good old races. I like what I'm seeing here. So next, it's finally gone gold. We finally have a release date. Neo 2, March 13,
2020. Uh-oh.
Releasing it on Friday.
Nope, that's not why I said uh-oh.
Oh?
Hold on. Friday the 13th, March 13th? Ooh. That's within a month of Cyberpunk's release. Oof. Not good.
That's not as much of a factor because you're not dealing with the same kind of game.
It's not the same kind of game here, but still.
No, there's no but still. What does Neo 2 and Cyberpunk have in common?
Not much. Like I said, I mean, all these spring releases, we're talking backup. It's like, you know what I mean?
The open beta is already out. I have tried a fair amount, and it's about what I asked for. So next, a bit of an update for Kingdom Come Deliverance.
Ooh, here we go.
They are adding modding tools.
About time. I could probably guess what took them so long, but I think they're trying to develop their fan base, so I can see why.
Well, that and they've done several expansions to the game, the last one being A Woman's Lot.
Man, I gotta check out these expansions, man. It's been a while since I played little Kingdom Come Deliverance.
Mm-hmm. It looks like the mod integration they're doing is with Nexus mods instead of Steam Workshop. Might make things a little bit tricky, but it is doable. Nexus does have a decent mod manager.
Oh, definitely. I use that all the time when I play Fallout.
Mm-hmm. Let's see. Then we had a reveal for a Cyberpunk meets Lovecraft themed game called Transient. The release date has not been stated. But it looks like we're doing a bit of first person, and already I can see the Lovecraftian vibe out of this.
Oh yeah.
Or apparently a hacker discovers a secret and the nightmares that it brings. And ooh boy. There's some. We're certainly having the nightmare aspect here. I get a bit of a amnesia vibe out of this.
Oh, yeah.
The definitely. Good amnesia, not a machine for pigs.
No. Yeah, and I wonder if there's going to be a game in the future that that'll be released that sort of reminds me of anyone remember Hell?
Yeah.
What are they gonna do with that? Because that was sort of like one of those quirky, interesting shit, you know. But then again, maybe it's just too much 90s influence, maybe.
Yeah, possibly. This is something that I get the feeling I might run through once or might try and talk Catlink if she would be willing to run this, but I don't see there's not enough mechanical there right now to go any further. And then we had, and this is going to be our last bit for the news, a FPS called Chains of Fury that is very. That is very Hellboy-esque.
Oh.
Especially with its art style. It's like the art style that Drake of the 99 Dragons wanted to do, but was too incompetent to do. And is that a quad barrel shotgun?
Yep, looks like it.
As far as doing destructible environments, some. Hopefully they're able to do it freely enough that we see something akin to Red Faction, but at least at least we have a case of, hey, if you can't find a door to get through the wall, just make your own door.
Hold up.
Apparently they've stated that one of their main claims to fame is that 80% of the game's world is destructible. So, it'll certainly be worth keeping an eye out. But with that said, it is time we tackle the crazy shit.
Oh yes, here we go.
Good Brother Shades, yeah. Play us in.
You forgot your soundboard doesn't work, and I don't have that one.
Oh God, hang on. Let me send you that one as well. Yeah, that's all botch. Right. That's botch number two here.
Oh, damn it! Oh, damn it!
A shameful display.
Yeah, here we go. I'll just screw it. I'll just. All right, come on. Here we go. It's time. Let's do this.
Ladies and gentlemen, the bar is open! It's time for Mildred the Monk's Geek of the Week!
And we open up with a fucking Florida Man!
Yes!
Florida fisherman believes he was sexually assaulted by a mermaid.
That's a cheers!
Oh, a little bit of the bubbly.
A local fisherman, Alvin McAllister. That's a little too close to Kevin. Has made an outrageous claim to a weird website. The fisherman claims that while he was lost at sea, he was sexually assaulted by a mermaid. McAllister made these claims when he was in a hospital after being lost at sea for 14 days. Medical records show that he was extremely dehydrated at the time.
Oh, boy.
Well, mermaids are swimming in a lot of salt water.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I mean, let's You know, like I said, if you're being sexually assaulted by a mermaid, I don't think you want to go home.
No.
But if he was stuck out at sea for 14 days straight, I think he might have been a little bit delirious.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
But then we had this little thing, and I asked Maddie about whether or not I was going to cover this, and decided, yeah, we may as well. So there was a 25% tax credit that was given to game development studios in Alberta. The thing is, this tax break was if your hiring was diverse enough.
Really?
The previous NDP government introduced the Interactive Digital Media Tax Credit last year, which is now going to be on its way out. It covered 25% of salaries and bonuses for staff, along with an additional 5% for employees of from diverse or underrepresented backgrounds.
Drink!
And apparently...
Why the hell would you do that?
Apparently, Beamdog has stated that he feels betrayed by this thing going down. It's like, you were trying to take advantage of a tax break to try and increase your amount of employees. That is a bad strategy.
No. Yeah. Bad, bad, bad. This is the thing, you know? Listen, I mean, this is the problem with tax credits. If there's some sort of a stipulation or something, believe me, that stipulation could be altered, or they'll add more fucking stipulations, or in this case, they'll be fucking Indian givers and toss it out entirely. You cannot live your business through fucking tax credits.
Yeah.
Just because it worked for Uwe Boll doesn't mean it'll work for you.
No.
Exactly. And Uwe Boll, you can't Uwe Boll your way into the industry. Sorry.
Mm-hmm.
And furthermore, I get the sense that the idea with this tax break was to try and bring more game dev studios, because I don't know, maybe they started getting jealous because they started seeing studios open up in Edmonton and Montreal.
Yeah.
Wait a minute, what am I saying? Edmonton's in Alberta.
Yeah.
But
yeah, Montreal.
Yeah.
But I think
we'll get to that later.
But what I see out of this is a case of there. You probably had a lot of aggressive expansion into this area simply because of this tax credit, instead of it building naturally. Especially since some of the companies that were banking on it were not based in Canada.
Oof.
New World Interactive is one example, since they're based in Denver, but they were going to open up a studio called New World North in Alberta.
Oh boy!
Apparently, the company was banking on using that funding to recruit talent.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, so basically, he's some idiot. Some of these idiots are trying to come in and grift off, trying to open a gaming industry and start grifting off it over in Alberta. He's trying to use that tax credit as a fucking loophole, but now that loophole's gone, and now they're crying over it. Well, no simpy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You should be in the gaming industry because you want to create some awesome and something original, not grifting.
Exactly.
You want to do that? Go work for Randy Bitchford.
I'm looking at some of the comments on the matter, or at least when I was able to before it mysteriously disappeared. But I don't know. Maybe Alberta has, as far from what I'm able to understand, One of the main exports that Alberta has in its to its advantage is oil.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
I guess they thought, we don't need that tax credit when we can just get money off of that.
Yeah.
I don't know who's the bigger dimwit, but either way, wit will be dimmed.
Yes.
Yeah.
So next, you know, Netflix Witcher, you had me, and then you lost me again.
I knew this shit was going to happen.
So according to a report, the Witcher's story will be focusing more on Ciri and Yennefer over Geralt.
Drink!
Fucking drink. You know, I knew they were gonna fuck it up. That showrunner was woke as a motherfucker. I knew something dumb was gonna happen, and lo and behold, it did.
But you want to know what's the other telltale sign?
What?
Andrzej Sapolsky, who I don't exactly care for, as you guys know, has stated he has no creative involvement in this series.
Then why the hell did you give off the rights, you idiot?
Because you know because he likes money.
Idiot. You know what?
Fuck you, I was right, 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 fuck you, I was right.
And the fact that he's not gonna be involved is going to put a detriment on factors. I remember, to put things in perspective, there were two shows that were adapting books that I was a big fan of when I was a little kid. Mm-hmm. Those were Goosebumps and Animorphs. Bob Stein was heavily involved in the creative input for Goosebumps.
Yeah.
Applegate was not involved with the TV version of Animorphs. Guess which one ended up doing better?
Goosebumps.
Yep. And of course, Lauren Hirsch has not helped matters. But when it comes to that focus, I'm going to put it out right now. I will not be watching the Netflix Witcher, and I get the feeling a lot of people won't either, because now that I've gotten a chance to see a lot of the footage, I have to point this out right now. It is trying way, way too hard to look like Game of Thrones.
Granted,
Witcher is not exactly what I would consider high fantasy, but at least with the games, in the art design, there is a sense of color. I can definitely say that. There's also the awkward fact that whoever designed the armor for the Nilfgaardians needs to be keelhauled.
Yeah.
You know what? Fuck it. All you assholes involved with this show, you're going someplace special. You're going to Detroit.
No! No, not Detroit! No! No, please! Anything but that! No!
I love that we've managed to get so much use out of that.
Yeah.
But on a plus side, Japan 1, NPCs 0. So everyone who was claiming who was whining about
the bubbly
about Uzaki-chan because apparently it's unrealistic for women to have large tits. Well, they are screwed.
Mm-hmm.
Now, and you know what? I wouldn't be surprised if after this whole thing, people end up wanting to try and read Uzaki-chan Wants to Hang Out.
Yeah. Watch. The Japanese Red Cross is going to double down and have Uzaki-chan in a fucking bikini.
I don't think they're going to do that, but mostly because the Japanese Red Cross doesn't have the authority to do that. Because Sora News 24 picked up the thing from Okatomu, which reported a quote saying, quote, English monk. This promotional campaign is merely providing a novelty gift to people who are kind enough to cooperate with our blood drive, and we do not recognize it as a form of sexual harassment. We have previously received support from numerous anime series in promoting blood drives, and these partnerships have been well received and increased the amount of blood that was donated. In regards to opinions about the current promotion, we're listening to them sincerely and will take them into consideration for future activities.
So basically Japan is saying, "Fuck you, baka no gaijin!"
Doctor, no, I am maintaining my moratorium when it comes to that. Although something that I really love when it came to the unseen Japan guy, apparently mm-hmm. he loved the fact that he was getting cited on a Japanese TV show until that TV show decided to not agree with him. Yeah. I had found that out on Twitter.
Yeah. But Doctor, no, I will say this: fuck Dominique's guy.
Apparently, mm-hmm. Sword News 42 thinks that the Red Cross will hold firm in their stance and continue to partner with anime manga properties, because partnering with anime for these sort of things, that's nothing new.
No, not at all. That is extremely common in Japan.
Oh, they do yep. it for both that, and they do it for recruitment for the JSDF.
Right.
So, just saying, there's... The only thing it's the fact that they went with somebody with a rack. That's the reason why Unseen Japan got so butthurt, and the fact that he or she continues to get ratioed every time is certainly helping
matters. Also, Slick Rick in the chat. Why do we have a feeling someone is going to promote their blood drive?
Listen here, okay. I don't know what's Unseen Japan, whoever the fuck you are, you're probably some goddamn gaijin piggybacking on the goddamn on the back culture. You know, if you don't like it so much, fuck out of there.
Yeah.
Tired of these I don't know what is it. You know what it is? I'll tell you what it is. The woke, the existence of Japan is a threat to their woken garbage. They can't monopolize as long as the Japanese are around. Because if the Japanese mm-hmm. are around and they produce far superior products, guess what? Their shit will lose every time.
Yeah. Fair enough.
So next, we have a case of the Darwin Awards. We were going to have a Darwin Awards monthly, and here we go. So a woman in Indiana... Of course it was Indiana, was found dead with an 8-foot python around her neck. There were approximately 140 caged snakes in her home.
Wow.
Well, it ain't cats, but still.
Yeah. But authorities are describing it as a reptile home.
Okay.
Crazy snake lady.
Yeah, that's a first. Usually when I hear snake related deaths, it has to do with those snake wranglers you see in Bible Belt churches who pay to protect them from
snake
venom.
Handler. Yeah. Snake handlers, idiots.
Let's see. She was identified as Laura Hurst, 36, was found in her home in the home of Oxford, Indiana, by Sergeant Kim Riley. About 20 of the 140 caged snakes were in the home, which she visited twice a week and belonged to her. Oh, Riley said no one lived at the residence. She was apparently checking on her snakes. For whatever reason, she apparently got the snake out and was doing what people do with snakes. There are so many ways I can take that.
Yeah.
All of them would get me kicked off YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. She's probably a little bit loopy.
Oh, yeah.
And filling around. And let's just say she's doing something that you'd probably find in most extreme hentai.
Yeah.
But all I'm going to end this with one little gag, because You would think that this would require the fail horn, but instead Instead, I have to go. Yep. Big ones, little ones, fat ones, skinny ones, protect me from the venomous drug that springs from the needles of fangs attacked by snakes. My snakes, so many snakes, you could fill the Great Lakes with snakes. Run, I try to hide, but snakes bite. God damn it, I fucked it up.
Degenerates like you belong on a cross.
And Rick is going, how is wearing a snake as a scarf is a bad thing? Allow me to give my impression of an Atlanta Falcon.
Okay.
And Airball, of course, brings up, I have had it with these motherfucking snakes on this motherfucking plane.
Of course.
But now it's time for us to laugh at Lamau.
Yeah, I question this article because it looks like you find something on the Onion or the Babylon Bee. But you know what? Fuck it, it's fun to read.
Yeah.
Yep. It's fun. It's fun to read. It's fun to read, and this is. And let me see if.
Yeah, I know the article's probably fake and gay, but who knows? Can't really tell these days.
Let me check on this thing. Oh. Apparently the whole thing started because he was trying to pump up the crowd saying let's go during the national anthem. And yep. it escalated because Dave Portnoy of Barstool Sports had said if this was the Chinese anthem, King James would have showed the proper respect. Best part is, if I recall correctly, they still lost against the Clippers.
Kawhi owns their ass. Yeah. But anyway, even if the article's fake and gay, let's just look at this. It's too funny.
Yeah. Actually, dear NBA, the Star Spangled Banner is an offense to people of color across America. To have played it before the games of the greatest player this league has ever known, me, is hugely insulting. It shows me that you do not respect your star. And this after all I've selflessly done for you. I demand this never happen again. You owe me. I saved this league and I can take it down. My departure now, when there is nobody close to equaling me ready to take my place, would devastate earnings. If I hear that crappy tune again, I'm done. I will walk away from the NBA forever. No playing, no coaching, no commentating. I will be history, and I'll take all the fans I brought in with me. It's either the song or me. Choose, respectfully, LeBron Ernest James.
I guess he wants this played before the games. Okay, enough of that. Here you go.
Yeah, if that's the case, I say, bye, bitch.
Yeah.
Now, I know, again, I know this article is probably fake and gay, but you know what? It wouldn't be too far from the truth if he actually did this.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Anyway. Yeah. Go live in China, you jag off. Again, mind the social credit system.
And now it's a case of...
this have shit I mentioned again!
Have I mentioned I hate Vox?
Crap.
Oh, shit. Here we go again.
Oh, God.
And this is all about them trying to they did a whole Vox, a supposed professional journalist site, is doing a whole thing on sexy cats because of cat costumes during Halloween.
Oh yeah. What? Yeah, once again, I mean, I know Halloween has passed, but come on. Again, he's like, yeah, I guess the outrage keeps going on even after Halloween. Be like, you can't wear this, you can't wear that, you can't... Oh, okay, so what are we supposed to do for Halloween, you jag?
Exactly.
I maintain that the person who had the best response to the wear a culture, not a costume thing was the Church of Satan. Why? Because they said, wear a culture, add a costume. Never mind the haters, go out and have fun. And if, before anyone wants to claim sacrilege, you do realize that church is just a bunch of trolls.
Yeah. I know it's trolls, but like I said, when even I have to agree with the Satanists, you know you fucked up.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah.
So next, and this is something that was interesting enough that Rackets decided to break from doing his usual long form videos, and instead did a short vid on this because the Sandman versus Washington Post thing has been reopened. We thought the case was done. And I was going to criticize how they overshot, but nope, he's reopened the case and it's going into discovery.
Discovery. This is the scenario they wanted to avoid. Because if something goes into discovery, you know a lot of dirty laundry is gonna be thrown out into the sun.
So,
oh, yeah.
On October 28th, Judge Burstelman ordered the case to be partially reopened following the filing of an amended complaint, noting that the statements alleged by the plaintiff to be defamatory have not changed in the proposed First Amendment complaint. The court, which will adhere to its previous rulings as they pertain to these statements, has made an exception to allow action on 3 of the 33 statements cited by Sandman in his original complaint. Quote, so statements 10, 11, and 33, to the extent that these 3 statements state that plaintiff blocked Nathan Phillips and would not allow him to retreat. Suffice to say, the court has given this matter careful review and concludes that justice requires that discovery be had regarding these statements and their context. The court will consider them anew on summary judgment.
Yeah,
so like it looks like the thing is being focused mainly on the actions of Nathan Phillips.
Yeah, mm-hmm. But you know what? This is the fucking foot in the door they needed.
You want to know what would be you want to know what would be really funny? If Nathan Phillips got deposed.
Oh fuck yeah!
Oh yeah.
Yeah, say okay, Nathan. We're gonna have you take a deposition, and we'll see what kind of bullshit he tries to cook us.
He's already been demonstrated with that whole Recon Ranger thing and some of the other stuff he claimed that he is a liar.
Yep. Now let's see if he can pull that bullshit under oath.
Well, there'll probably be some lies, but. But he's gonna have to go against people who are not going to be sympathetic.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm. And apparently the 3 statements, and even if they're focusing on Phillips, the Washington Post is still gonna get involved because they were the ones who published those statements, and more specifically published Phillips' opinions on Sandman's actions as fact, citing Phillips' interpretation as being subjective matters of opinion. And they bring up the 3 quotes here. Now, in his previous ruling, he had stated that these statements were not about Sandman, they were descriptive of his actions. But it seems that's not exactly the case.
Hmm.
And of course, the Washington Post has declined to comment. Good, they're smart.
Yeah.
Now, as far as the lawsuits against CNN and NBC, that's still ongoing. But yeah, I get the feeling that if the way things are going, this might have a ripple effect for the other cases, because I think the Washington Post had reported on the matter first, and then other stations picked up on it, and that's how it spread.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So if WAPO's shit's gonna move to Discovery, you bet your ass the other lawsuits are gonna move into Discovery as well.
Mm-hmm.
Ooh.
Now I don't think there's gonna be a whole lot of punishment doled out to CNN and NBC. Relatively, I do think that Washington Post is, if worst case scenario, they end up taking the brunt of it.
Yeah.
Because like I said, but the thing is, their fear isn't pretty much losing the case. It's far from it. Their fear is Discovery. So if this moves into Discovery, they're screwed.
Mm-hmm.
Because the worst that happens is the money is not the issue here. It's their inner work, is them asking to look into the inner workings. That's the issue. And if those inner workings are made public, something real, it's going to be one hell of a shitstorm.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, I can definitely see that. So next, Tony Isabella, and this is why I said in the docket that I consider him right and wrong with his statement that Batman has become a toxic character. Where he did a Facebook statement where back on the 23rd, he had stated that he describes Batman as toxic and the ruination of DC Comics in response to invites to Facebook groups about Batman, then writing, "Here's a tip. Don't ask me to join groups or visit pages that have Batman in their titles. He was once my favorite comics hero. Now I consider him the most toxic and the ruination of DC Comics." He added, "DC hurts their other characters by making Batman the center of their universe."
I can see why you say he's right and wrong, because the right part is like, you basically gave Batman the Roman Reigns treatment.
Yeah.
Yep.
But toxic, that's a little bit of a stretch, don't you think?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. He would then criticize a number of websites who covered his comments and called them low-life comic news sites, and he specifically called out Bleeding Cool, so that deserves a cheers.
Oh, definitely. Mm-hmm. Definitely.
Oh, yeah.
Oh! A little bit of the bubbly!
Yeah, he claims that he's been harassed and insulted due to their coverage, after condemning his critics as creeps and low-lifes, and noting that he's blocking many of them. Yeah, don't do the whole mum mentions. It doesn't make you look good.
Yeah, no.
But he specifically called out Rich Johnston and Jude Terror. Good. Fuck those guys.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like I said, listen, I understand out of all the DC characters, Batman has been the most successful. But, like I said, but that doesn't mean you should shove him down everybody's throat. I mean, shit. I think Superman used to get that treat before like the 80s.
Mm-hmm. Now, here's the thing. You knew that calling him toxic was going to have an incendiary response. So, no simpy, Isabella.
Nope.
No.
You're right. I understand why you don't like the character that's oversaturated. Fine. But if you're going to go with that bullshit, language, no simpy.
Now, that said, he is right in the fact, and this is something that we've covered, and the fact that we did a double take when we ended up agreeing with Rob Liefeld, of all people, is that they do have, DC Comics does have a Batman problem. And just to illustrate my point, I'm going to go on Comicron right now, and let's look at the top 10 for the last month. So we're looking at September 2019. So what we... So let me...
Oh boy.
So as far as the estimates. So let's see what we have for top 10. Spawn number 300. Spider-Man number 2. Spider-Man number 1. House of X number 5. Powers of X number 5. House of X number 4. Doomsday Clock number 11. Absolute Carnage number 3. Deceased, A Good Day to Die, number 1. Harleen, number 1. And that's it. So, I'd say this isn't exactly the best instance, but the fact that they only got two DC comics in the top 10. Deceased, which seems to be a DC version of Marvel Zombies, and Harleen, which I think would help that matter is having a very prolific artist handle that. But again, yeah. Harleen is part of that whole web with Batman, so back to square one.
Yeah.
Yep.
Again, you're not wrong, Tony Isabella. You're just a dick.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of which, so the senior editor of Heavy Metal, or Metal Hurlant, has resigned and claimed that she was the target of a bullying campaign. Now, normally, I would assume that this is a case of mementions, but in this case, there's a bit more to it.
Ooh. So, mementions.
So she had said, on October 22nd, editors at Heavy Metal received a memo stating that CEO and one of the owners of the company, Jeff Krelitz, also our day-to-day boss, had resigned from his position at the company. I continued my editing duties alongside my managing editor, Tom Seeley, and others, but found myself increasingly faced with administrative duties that were not included in my contract due to changes within the company. Sometimes this extra work resulted in several more hours per day. When I asked that I be compensated for the extra time I was spending on these non-contracted duties, I was told by owners Paul Redder and Lexi Leon that the company couldn't commit to extra pay at that time, and they hoped I would continue to do the extra work anyway. That's fucking stupid.
Yeah.
Bad idea. Mm-hmm.
Meanwhile, mm-hmm. It became clear to me that Krelitz had not resigned, but been removed, and there was an intense conflict between the partners at Heavy Metal over the future of the company. However, I wasn't permitted to have any formal communication with him to help with the transition of his many projects or outstanding business that affected me as senior editor. On October 27th, I was asked to hand over all documentation related to a series of projects in development at the company, to which I compiled same day. Over a rapid-fire series of emails, I was informed that my documentation was not sufficient, asking me to provide more documents for these early-stage projects. The problem was those documents were not in my possession and, to my knowledge, didn't exist. When I explained there were no further documents, the line of questioning didn't stop there. Relentless emailing, sometimes quite aggressive, came in from Lexi Leon, questioning me and pushing me to find development materials for these projects. When I pointed out that any materials not yet under contract were owned by creators and not the company, and therefore not empowered to deliver, the question became even more intense and pointed, suggesting that I was withholding information. I brought all this to the attention of my managing editor and asked that he be included in these conversations, since they were making me uncomfortable. He proceeded to confirm my statement that we did not have possession of the materials they were looking for. I explained the terms of creator ownership in the absence of contracts and was told by Leon that they needed the materials only to assess the existence of projects. However, they also wanted to take possession of the material and prevent competing companies from developing similar projects based on the pitch materials creators might have created.
Oh my god. It's, you know what? Sounds like she's getting Miltoned out of the company.
Yeah.
This isn't a case of mum mentions or anything like that. This is crossing ethical lines. In fact, that's what she said. That's what she goes into next.
The only thing it's missing is it doesn't involve a goddamn stapler.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
What's up, bitches?
Hey, Shades, how's it going?
Same old, my friends.
Yep. We are currently on the heavy metal story where it seemed like somebody quit over being harassed, but there is a bit more to the story. Go ahead.
Yeah. It's less mementions. Of course, there is still mementions garbage going around, but it's more like she's getting Miltoned out of the company.
Nah.
Except, and unfortunately, it doesn't involve a red stapler.
Yep. And game fan, yes, we did mention Neo 2 earlier. So apparent the vibe of it is that Hannah means Shannon was the senior editor for Heavy Metal, and
back in a sec.
She was asked to provide documents that the publication did not own because they were at that time owned by their creators. And she was being pressured to violate her own ethics to send those documents due to the fact that one of the CEOs of the company had left, although she suspects that he didn't leave, he was run out. And the thing, apparently, in the wake of all this, it was discovered that Heavy Metal magazine does not have a HR representative.
Oh.
Yep. You go, because at the end of it, she says, "If you're wondering why I don't speak to HR to resolve this issue, HR doesn't have an HR department or an HR officer. I have no recourse." So she after that she gave her notice, and that was 10 days from the posting of that thing, which was October 29th. So yeah, this is a case of I can't even go with the mentions thing because it wasn't like she was effectively getting bullied by her boss, not by people ratioing her. There are no hot takes here. So this is a case of a legit bullying campaign, and I would not be surprised if she files a workplace lawsuit in the coming months.
All right.
Yeah, neither would I.
Which is a shame, because I like Heavy Metal magazine.
Uh-huh.
I always have.
And of course, another publication has turned into a dumpster fire.
At least this isn't a dumpster fire based on wokeness. This is a dumpster fire based on incompetence.
Yep.
And the possibility of a boys' club, but...
Oh, definitely. So basically, he's turned into the Hawks.
Yep. So next, we have a case of NPCs hate. And this specifically is over a couple pages from an art book, from an art guide book.
Oh, this dumbass. I basically chewed this moron out on Twitter.
Oh, yeah.
Because this person is trying to claim that if your women look like the image that is shown, that he or she is legally obligated to amputate your hands. Try me,
oh,
bitch.
Oh, fuck off!
Put him in the fucking bedroom. Get him out of here. Come on.
Putting aside that the book in question has a variety of I did a little bit of digging on this particular book, and it has a variety of art styles and different artists present. Not just one
so
particular
basically
style.
She's cherry picking.
Yeah, this is a. Are any of you familiar with the term quote mine?
Yep.
That's what this is.
It's quote mining, this is cherry picking, call it what you will, but it's bullshit.
Mm-hmm. And of course, she got ratio.
Yeah, as she should, because here's the thing. Okay, you don't like sexualized characters, fine. You don't have to like it. But there's a lot of people that do, so guess what? They're not going to stop. Just get over yourself.
Exactly.
Now, Salamandir had pointed out a few other examples from the book. And I'm going to show some of these. So You have this one up front, which is very fairy tale esque. Then you have a guide on contour characteristics of male characters, which is very cartoonish, and another one that looks like something I would see in early Disney.
All right.
So it's either she's completely ignorant, which could be the case, or she doesn't want those styles being drawn. Only the CalArt style is acceptable.
The vibe I get out of this is that what probably happened is they saw the image getting shared on Reset Era, and then they tweeted about it. And then
of things course,
yeah. from there. Of course.
And hey, there, Misanthropic, you missed out on your chance to scream about mechs, especially since I know you're a fan of Armored Core. Because there is a one man show that I'm going to have to put in the Discord and specifically tag you, which I will do after the show, that I think you are going to get a kick out of.
Yeah.
Yep. So next we have, I want to thank Ewan McGregor for saving me $10, because based on what he's been saying lately, I know that I have absolutely no desire to see Birds of Prey. I didn't have much desire anyways, but now he's describing Black Mask as a villain for the age of Trump.
Oh, for fuck's sake!
Oh!
Fucking Drake!
Yeah, Drake!
Black Mask...
Orange Man Bad!
Black Mask is a mob boss. A very ruthless mob boss.
Exactly.
Exactly what is Time of Trump or Age of Trump for him? He describes the character as an absolute narcissist. He's not.
Nope. Yeah, clearly.
If there's anybody in Batman's Rogues Gallery who I consider a narcissist, it would probably be the Riddler.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
But Black Mask, not written.
Oh, press an X.
No.
Yeah.
Apparently, they're also bringing in Victor Zsasz, who they're probably going to screw up as well.
Oh yeah.
They're trying to tease the idea of Black Mask and Victor Zsasz having a romantic relationship, and no!
Drink!
Like, Zsasz is the nuttest of nut jobs.
Yes. Yeah, he's right. He's like, yeah, I think he's like, what, second to only the Joker.
Yeah.
In terms of his insanity, yes. Although, in his case, it has to do with a hyper fixation on getting his mark.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
All right, boys, I got half an hour. What do you got?
Hey there, Matty.
All right, to be fair, I got a little bit more time, but yep. Hello.
Hello.
Hey, Aaron.
What?
How about that AEW last week, huh?
I didn't catch it a lot, but I heard.
They managed to break the internet. Again.
Oh, yeah. Shit they ever.
Yeah.
Yep.
But.
Oh, I did see that.
True story. I was watching that live, and it was so hard not to blurt out Kenny Omega as Sans while the monk was working his game.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it was all hard. Oh, yeah. Now I remember. Undertale, really?
Yep.
Hey, that's my territory, man.
Don't piss in someone else's pool. Two, this is a repeat thing for Kenny Omega. He is a giant fucking nerd.
Yeah.
Anyway.
I'm assuming we're at Geeks now.
Yep. And yes. Now it's time for us to talk about the fan art that broke the internet. Specifically when Devil HS did a busty version of Ray that got every NPC in a pissy.
Yeah, I've seen this.
And just to further on the trolliness, he then followed up by doing a sexy version of Kylo Ren, which was basically shirtless. So so if you're thinking about Ned Flanders, good for you. You have taste.
Yes.
Stupid sexy Flanders.
Again.
They even got a fucking animated GIF of her.
I didn't see that one either. But again, you don't have to like this shit. But honestly, from a drawing perspective, just looking at it as an art, it looks great. Like it's well detailed. It's got good shading. It looks good.
Yeah.
This is the thing. They don't like. No. Here's the deal. They don't want. It's like whenever someone tries to improve on it to make it look tolerable, they're always whining about it because it's like the Zera shit all over again.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's like, oh, how dare you draw something other than Keller style? This is where I start beating someone over the head with a goddamn screwdriver. In fact, you know what I'm going to do right now? Those of you bitching about this shit, you know what? Where should I send them?
Where else do you send them?
Detroit!
Roxy!
No! No, not Detroit! No! No, please! Anything but that! No.
I was thinking about sending them to LA, but Detroit works.
The one that I found that was particularly egregious was Wayward Anarchist Snake saying, "This is why men are not allowed to have rights." Fuck you!
What?
Yep.
What you just said is one of the most insanely idiotic things I have ever heard. At no point in your rambling, incoherent response were you even close to anything that could be considered a rational thought. Everyone in this room is now dumber for having listened to it. I award you no points, and may God have mercy on your soul.
Yep. And Devil HS, whose work I'm very familiar with.
It's not me! Yeah.
Oh, God! Damn it!
Kill me with this! And you pissed off on Kelly!
Robert.
You happy now?
You're trying to kill me!
You know some pedos. Go find their fucking address book.
So he goes in the past. So Devil HS made a response saying, "In the past day, I've got more sexist insults than I got in my entire life." And that's the thing that I find especially amusing is that the people, and I think I said this in that rant that I did in that long post I did after you had posted your soapbox shades. It's kind of funny that the people who are the biggest sexists and the biggest racists and the biggest bigots are the people who claim to fight against sexism, racism, and bigotry.
Pretty much.
This is what I always say. Show me someone who's extraordinarily woke, and I'll show you someone who's extraordinarily racist or extraordinarily sexist.
Mm-hmm. You know what? On that, you played R. Kelly. Let's check in with Vince real quick.
Take your time. Come on. Go.
Oh, shit. He's going to his house. He's going to his house.
Yep.
Yeah. For those of you who don't follow me, like I know most of my audience has seen this, but yeah, what Monk was pointing out is I recently did A Shades of Soapbox. Basically, it's my little rant series.
No, we don't need the music.
Not in this case. I only play that on here when I'm actually going to get ready to go on a rant.
Okay.
But I recently did a video about cancel culture and SJWs, and I called them the fuck out. If you guys want to follow me on my channel, I'll probably find me, and you can look me up on here. So if you're on YouTube, you can easily just pull up my profile.
So you looked up the video, and while it's good, but you didn't go hard on them enough.
Because I'm limited by time, assholes. But I was limited by time. But trust me, if I wanted to make the video longer, I sure as hell could have gone all out. I had other examples that I could have brought up.
Let's put it this way: he went as hard as he wanted to. He couldn't have gone far harder, of course, but he didn't have to.
Mm-hmm. Now, one thing he does point out, and this is what I want to focus on. He said, "I get that you may dislike the drawing a lot because it meddles with your favorite character, and I respect that. But I feel like saying that all men are a disease is a bit much."
You think?
Hey, look. I'm 297 pounds right now. I don't feel like a disease.
Here's the thing. You know what it is? And for those people who are so bitching about it, just keep in mind, most of these motherfuckers, we're gonna load up we need to bring out the champagne bottles because these fuckers are fucking shippers.
Well, I'm not gonna focus on the shipper thing. What I am gonna focus on is that these are the same people who would who would endorse people doing edits of characters that we may like. Like, remember that one person who did that edit to try and edit several characters from Xenoblade Chronicles 2?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
And all the Yas Queens that person got. Just saying. But on the plus side, the artist struck back. So we have Tanasu doing one, we have Miss Society doing one.
That's a good one.
We have Joan Pedraz doing one. We have
let me see this one.
We have Tino Bite doing one. We have Drawsputin.
What do you know about my back? I can lift a bunch of boulders, but I can't handle my back.
We have Drawsputin doing The Rise of Skynockers. Image Incorporated doing their own take. And we have Devil HS doing a redraw of his original art, just with Ray turning to the dark side.
Yes.
Doko!
About time!
Late and fake! Also, I'm going to say this right now. These guys, this is what happens when you try to step on this kind of thing. They're going to go Tifa Lockhart on your ass.
Uh-oh.
And more shoulder deep.
Yeah, if you've seen fan art of Tifa Lockhart from back in the day and how big they made her, just wait. That's about to happen to Rey.
Yeah, so
on the plus side, it exposed me to a lot more artists. So keep getting butt mad. It makes me get to see more people's work.
Now,
excuse me, Barbara Streisand.
Yeah, like I said, you know. You know who surprises me, though, who I haven't seen him do a rendition of this yet?
Who?
Pablo Romero.
Give it time. He just did that Captain Marvel thing. I think
Captain Marvel.
I think he's trying to break the internet again.
You know what? Not to bring in another running gag from Tokaris, but start the clock.
Yep.
Right. So next we have the fact that they got... Oh!
What?
Hello there, Doku. Welcome back to the bar.
Oh, I have drinks that need to be made.
buddy, my current contract ends this Friday. I'm drinking on next Sunday.
Oh, my finger is bleeding a little bit, so,
Oh, God.
Drink. Because...
Oh, yeah. Especially for this next one.
Drink.
Oh god, we're stepping into my territory again.
Yep.
Drink for fucking stupid teenagers that don't know what the fuck they're doing. Cause oh boy. Oh. You guys want a fucking fun story?
Well, you got time.
Sure.
So, I was pulling in to my driveway, and as I was turning left, these fucking idiots decided to speed up. And yeah, because I'm an asshole, I sped it up and I turned left, going into my driveway. Then they decided to fucking come to a screeching halt and yell, "Hey, fuck you." So I decided, "Hey, fuck you too." Woke up my neighbors. And, "Hey, Mildra."
Yes?
I've told you that I'm a practitioner, or I'm a practitioner of Kenjutsu, right?
Yes, you have.
Don't tell me you chop some people's head, chop people's limbs off.
I took out my fucking Tombo katana.
Oh.
And fucking pulled that shit out. And I stopped my car in the middle of the fucking street, got out, pulled out my fucking sword. And, "Hey, come here." They left.
"Get back here. I just want to be my friend. I'm going to be your friend. Get back here."
Drunk motherfucker with a sword. We're out of here.
Run away! Run away!
Granted, I nicked my finger. I didn't cut it, but I nicked it just a little bit. But the thing is, I didn't nick it enough to even actually have to clean my blade. But damn, those motherfuckers are lucky, because just that tiny little nick, it you might call it a cat scratch. But, that was just me drawing the fucking sword. Coming outside of my fucking car, like, "All right, get out here, motherfucker. Really fucking quick. I'm going to fucking gut you." I was already in a fucking bad mood, and you just fucking almost ran me off the fucking road. Oh, yeah. I'm about to fucking kill you.
Back. And to the left. Back.
Back. And to the left. To the left.
Back.
To the left.
Into the left. I think this calls for Anchorman.
Yep.
Give me a minute.
Boy, that escalated quickly.
Yep. The thing is, I'm not joking. These motherfuckers ran straight through a fucking stop sign. And normally I would have been okay with that. It's the fact that they fucking came to a screeching halt and yelled, "Hey, fuck you," and I yelled, "Hey, fuck you," back. Then they came to the fucking screeching halt. That's when I got out of the fucking car and pulled the fucking sword. I was like, "Okay, let's do this. I'm already in a bad mood. I'm gonna fucking kill you."
Ladies and gentlemen, what have we learned?
Road raging.
Don't ever fuck with good brother Doku.
Mm-hmm.
Nope.
So,
anyway.
Now, I should note, this is not the first time tonight that we have stepped into your territory, because earlier tonight, before you came in, Shades, there was a bit of an update on the whole Uzaki-chan thing regarding the Japanese Red Cross. They told Unseen Japan et al. To go pound sand. They're keeping they're keeping the promotion, and it seems to have worked, because they've gotten a lot more people donating blood this year.
Yeah. No.
When?
Mm-hmm. But there are also, now I have not seen Yuna and the Haunted Hot Springs, but apparently they are butt mad over over one page in the 181st chapter that was in Weekly Jump 48. Wait a minute,
I know that cover.
Yeah, here's the thing. It's the cover that's the issue. I was actually just looking into this. I was just reading the story to get myself prepared for this. So basically, here's what's going on. The front cover is Yuna basically laid out, fully nude, but they have clever censorship like you would normally do. They use like the steam to kind of hide the nipples. But here's the kicker. The inside cover has them drinking bubble tea, and some of the boba bubbles are floating at the top. And if you run a light behind that cover, you can kind of see through in just the right way to make it look like you can actually see the nipples.
So they're mad about a cover gimmick.
Intentional or not? Yeah. Pretty much.
You know, because it's not like we had to deal with cover gimmicks every fucking week back in the 90s. And I am not going to be showing the NSFW version because I like keeping my channel. But
even the safer work version is not something you should be showing.
Yeah. But they decided to go with the Maw Miners, and I really need that Simpsons clip about would someone please think about the children?
Fuck the children.
Carlin, do it right. What about the children? Save the children. You know what I say? Fuck the children. And this is Mr. Conductor talking. I know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, they're worthless anyways.
Yeah, well, most of them. Some kids, winners. The rest of them, a whole lot of losers. I should know.
I'm looking a little bit more into this series, and yeah, the girl's a ghost. Who knows how old she is at this point? You can't even pull the age card on this shit. I hate when they do that shit. Yeah, she looks young, but not. She doesn't look that young. I'd say late high school at worst.
Well, let's not forget that. That these are the same people who tried to argue that somehow Nezuko was actually a little kid.
Yeah, and all these idiots.
except for the fact that she actually had a fucking child.
Yeah,
she was a mother.
Not only that, it's like these same people that are basically saying, "Oh, you're lonely, you're a pedophile," but at the same. But also them, they sexualize children on the daily.
Well, let's not forget that one of the people who really got on that moral high train, turns out they had a few skeletons in their closet. Granted, everyone has shit in their closet they don't want public. I get that, but here's what I counter with: people in glass houses shouldn't throw stones.
Very much.
But someone else pointed out that this same publication, and keep in mind I think this was published through Jump Weekly, and mm-hmm. one other person had pointed out that they've had a fair amount of etchy stuff. They've run Bastard, To Love Rue, some of this Dragon Ball, especially with some of its early stuff, and Food Wars. also Ichigo 100%. So nothing new. And someone
by the way, drink for Food Wars being involved. That's awesome.
Yeah. Right. Cheers.
And oh, you know what? Yeah, that is a cheers.
And The person who started this whole thing, Sachiko Ishikawa, they decided to put their shit on protected mode. Sounds like somebody couldn't handle a few bee stings. Again.
Oh no.
Yeah, Sachiko, dear. Don't lie with Gaijin dogs. Don't lie with.
I'm not even sure that. I'm not even sure. I don't even think she's Japanese. I think.
Oh, you think she's a? She's a. Yeah, probably an American. You think she's an American born?
I think she. I'm not gonna go that far, but I think. But I think she. I think she's a fucking poser.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I wouldn't blame it.
Yep. So next we have Discovery's Mary Chieflo, and Chieflo, and fix your damn face and get rid of that fucking face ornament, you goddamn idiot. Sorry.
What
bad,
the hell?
Bad character design throws me into fury.
Oh, you got the Sarah. Oh, you got the Sarah reaction.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
So, Mary Chieflo, who plays Chancellor Laurel in Discovery, had claimed on Twitter about who they should replace Benioff and Weiss for Star Wars, since those two guys are not working on whatever Star Wars project they were going to be working on.
Yes, good.
Citing a full schedule with a recently inked Netflix deal.
Nah, they're just cowards. But anyway,
she decided to put up. And hang on, I have to do the NPC voice. Which of the following would be a super freaking smart and bad ASS choice for a replacement? A woman. B,
you mean
a
whammon?
Person of color. C, a member of the LGBTQ+ community. Day, all of the above.
Oh God! Well,
I heard turn into a fucking Dalek.
I heard
that's the NPC voice. I'll try.
Hey, Chieflo.
Oh, sounds like Dalek to me.
That's fair.
Or better yet, Chumfo. I heard Juicy Smoulier is available.
Nah. He's very available, but not for too long though. So you gotta hurry up.
Yeah,
ladies.
Yeah, I know what you say, but he's a man. No, he just acts like a woman.
Mm-hmm.
And ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, let's get ready to ratio.
Ratio.
No, if we're gonna do it right. And now for the thousands in attendance and millions watching at home potentially. Let's get right into the ratio.
Hold up. You guys gotta do this. You gotta do this right.
For the thousands in attendance
and the millions watching around the world. Let's get ready to ratio.
There we go.
Oh,
third time's the charm. And look who we have. We have Mecha Random.
Mecha Random, Josiah. Oof.
Mm-hmm. Colin Cochran. And somebody pointed out, I guess the disabled don't matter. And she immediately backpedals.
Bitch! Bitch! Did she just
say the disabled don't count and back away like a bitch?
Yes, he did.
That's how you get one on these fucking jagoffs.
But let's be
speaking as a quote unquote disabled person. Go fuck yourself. Continue.
Let's be clear on something. She's probably one of the many people who's butthurt about the fact that Game of Thrones prequel or something ended up getting shit canned. And the only reason she cares is because woman director. And to be quite honest, the idea of doing a Game of Thrones prequel would have been a bad idea anyways.
No.
Because
after the shit show that was the last few episodes of that last season, yeah, that's good and dead for at least 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Yeah, don't do a damn thing until George R. R. Martin finishes his next book, which
Will be one day after Half-Life 2 comes out. Not Half-Life 2, Half-Life 3 comes out.
Pretty much, yeah.
And 3 days after Mountain Blade Bannerlord comes out. But I just realized that is two ratios in a row. In fact, possibly three.
Ladies and gentlemen,
And I want to see F's in the chat for the end of the for the fact that the Dolphins tank has stepped on a landmine.
Oh, a landmine called the butt fumble.
Mm-hmm.
But see, that's what happens when you mess with a butt fumble. They make you butt fumble.
They make you butt fumble your tank.
Mm-hmm. Anyway,
so the next thing that we have is from the Atlanta Black Star, where they're once again trying to defend the HBO Watchmen. Now, I will say, I sat through one episode of HBO's Watchmen. I did not come back.
That bad? Wow.
Here's the problem that I had. This isn't Watchmen. Like
This is Wokeman.
A fair argument.
Yeah, that's fair.
Like, why the hell would Rorschach be a symbol for quote unquote white supremacy?
What is a Watchman? What's actually a good guy?
Rorschach?
Yeah,
I wouldn't call him good.
Oh, or an anti-hero at best.
But
yeah,
the closest that you could make that argument is the fact that he was a Republican and very critical of bleeding heart liberals. That's really it, and even that doesn't factor into some of the other stuff that is at the forefront with his personality, namely the fact that he has a very black and white attitude about things, which is the reason why he was at the end of both the comic and the movie, he was screaming at Dr. Manhattan to kill him because he knew he couldn't just look the other way regarding the whole alien thing.
Yeah.
Or the means that they used to basically stop the Cold War. It was the right thing to do, but he has no capacity for compromise.
Uh-huh.
But they're trying to argue that the reason why fanboys don't like Watchmen is because it deals with race and white supremacy. Let me make something perfectly clear, Regina King. You do not deal with it. You try and sugarcoat it so you can pretend that you are fighting the good fight. You ain't.
No.
Furthermore, that was never a factor with the original Watchmen.
No.
Yeah.
If you want to argue that it's about modern times, you'd still be wrong, because a story like Watchmen is far too entrenched of what was happening at that time, when it was legitimately thought that a nuclear war was going to happen.
Right.
Mm-hmm. It is a product of its time.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Much in the same way that V for Vendetta is a product of Thatcher era politics.
Mm-hmm.
But trying to make it about the Civil War, if you want a story about Civil War and Civil Rights Movement and all that, make that damn story. There's no need to bring Watchmen into this.
No.
Yeah, and how I discovered something. I forgot who this author was. His last name is Duff or something. It's sort of an alternate take on the Civil War, where the Civil War turned into like a century long conflict.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
that began around 1861, but the South won that battle, and basically there was a series of wars that happened that culminated in World War II, where the South is being run by that equivalent of a yeah,
right,
yeah, but
interesting stuff. Interesting stuff, by the way.
Well, if you can find the link, put it up in its appropriate spot.
All right.
By the way, before we continue, so Monk, you know your replica of the Ring of Honor world title, right?
Yeah.
We're about to be twinsies.
You got one too.
Oh boy.
Long story short, there's a Facebook group that I belong to. It's a private group, but every once in a while, they hold raffles to raise money for charity. And one of them was the Autism Self-Advocacy Network, which is a charity that John and I full-heartedly support. I put in my $5 in before I'm back on the unemployment line, and bada bing, bada boom, I have a replica of the Ring of Honor, the same one, actually.
Nice. Same version
coming my way.
Nice.
I won the raffle.
Yeah, damn. Thank also, God.
Matt, that's your one.
Which means I'm about to lose anyway in about 10 minutes.
So Matt, I'm not
show
worried.
Up at MetroCon, we have to do a title for title photo.
Ooh, absolutely.
I will be happy to take that photo. Anyway, moving on.
All right. So next, you know, I thought I was done taking shots at Rooster Teeth, and to a lesser extent, taking shots at DC, and then this shit happens.
Oh,
so
God.
Just when you thought you was out, they pull you back in.
So Rooster Teeth partnered with DC to do a Ruby comic, and for all intents and purposes, the comic doesn't look all that bad. But there was one little factor. namely a revolver that we see Glenda using that looks a little bit similar to the Dust Trivolver that was created by fan artist Chris Lee.
Dust Trivolver?
Yeah, Trivolver.
Yeah.
And oops. To put things in perspective, I'm going to share two images in the council. The first is the panel, and I'm not going to play the video. The second is a YouTube vid of the weapon in question.
Oh. Yeah, just looking at the two, it is not even subtle.
Oh yeah.
I'm mulling the bones.
Oh, definitely.
Fuck up.
Yeah.
Yep. You're gonna have to go back to the drawing board or start. Open up that wallet.
Mm-hmm.
Apparently, he had published this design on May 25th, 2015, about 4 years before the release date of Ruby number 5. Word of this reached him, and he said, "Thanks for the heads up. I haven't been following the comics. I saw the Reddit post as well. Are these the only frames it appears, or does anyone have a link to the chapter? I've never been contacted by Rooster Teeth or DC. I had a similar situation with the sniper rifle in Volume 3, but this one is much more spot on." And yeah, they point out the Mei Zedong character using the rifle in a previous volume, and his sniper battle axe rifle that he had shared. And that one isn't quite as close. It's still different enough, but it is borderline.
Yeah,
a little bit.
Yep, they better pay him fast or fix it, otherwise you're going to court.
Let's see. According to Rooster Teeth's terms of use for their website, users who create fan works or user submissions relating to the services provided by the website, defined as sites, products, or any offerings we provide, such as Red versus Blue or Ruby, must release Rooster Teeth from any and all claims, demands, liabilities, and causes of action, whether now known or unknown, for defamation, copyright infringement, violation of moral rights, an invasion of the rights to privacy, publicity, or personality, or any similar matter based on relating to the use of your user submissions. So it's not, he wouldn't have a case as far as a lawsuit, but the fact that they didn't credit him,
that's what grinds his gears.
Whereas they credited Inkyo 24 when it came to the concepts for the Mantator Grimms as a fan art.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very bad look.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
To say the least.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, boy.
Now, Rooster Teeth did issue a response. Although, me personally, I think the person who should be responding to this is DC Comics, not Rooster Teeth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I can agree with that.
So one of their folks had made a comment on the site to address the issues, saying, "I just wanted to take a second to address a hiccup in our Ruby XDC comics. As you may have heard, the most recent digital issue of Ruby comic features Glenda wielding a dust pistol. Unbeknownst to us at RT, this pistol looked very similar to a piece of fan art created by one of our fandom, a talented guy named Chris Lee. I just want to set the record straight here. In no way was it anyone's intent to copy Chris's design and put it into the comics. We were not aware of Chris's work. Press X. Nor did we seek to use his design in the comics. Our incredible DC artist, Mirka Andolfo, is not a Rooster Teeth employee and creates her art outside of company walls. We review and approve every single panel of the comics, but we did not know that the weapon Mirka had drawn was similar to Chris's fan art. So to be clear...
Hit it again.
None of us knew any of this until it was flagged by you, our amazing fans. When this came to our attention late last week, we immediately updated the art in the digital comic to alter the look of the weapon. This alteration will also be represented in the physical version that releases in comic shops everywhere this year.
So basically, instead of paying the guy... they decide to alter it. Well, that's a little bit scummy, don't you think?
Well, they're altering. All they did was just remove the blade on the top.
They removed the blade on the top and they changed the barrel.
Yeah.
That's about it.
And it doesn't even look like a proper barrel now.
Mm-hmm. I don't know.
It looks like Han Solo's pistol. But
yeah,
what I see out of this is the whole thing of we didn't intend to copy Chris Lee's design. I don't care whether or not you intended. You still did it.
Yeah. Oh, we didn't mean to copy his shit. It's just a coincidence.
Bullshit.
I'm not expecting them to go over every single submission, but when this was brought up, what you should have done, and this would have been a very clear thing to do, is if you actually said we actually credited Chris Lee in a tweet or something, and then maybe brought him in to consult. That's what you did with the Manticore Grim.
Mm-hmm.
That's why people are pissed at you.
Yeah.
And it's just one more thing in a long list of things why they're mad at you, because I'm pretty sure they still want your head on a spike for that whole Genlock Season 2 thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're not doing yourself any favors, Rooster Teeth.
No.
Now, there could be some debate about whether or not this is on DC, this is a fault of DC fucking up or a fault on Rooster Teeth fucking up. But as far as I'm concerned, the fish rots from the head.
Yep.
Yeah.
So I am aiming my shots at both of them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
All right.
So next, now we talked about this beforehand, but it's been official. The Game of Thrones prequel that was supposed to be led by Naomi Watts is dead, and all that there was just a pilot of it.
Really?
You!
Just the pilot?
Yep. And we lost Doku.
I thought the future was female.
Apparently Doku this drop. Pilot was supposed to focus on the age of heroes in the first battle between man and White Walker.
You mean Whammon and White Walker?
This is the Game of Thrones fan in me talking, but goddamn, that's man versus White Walker.
Yeah.
I would have wanted to see that.
Here's the thing for me personally. I've never been a fan of doing prequels to a work that's already finished unless you add something significant. And focusing on the age of heroes, which I think was meant to be something abstract for that story, does not feel right.
No,
I'm glad they just did away with it, because trust me, they'd fuck this one up as well.
Yep. Yeah.
So they've decided not to move forward with it, and all that there was just a pilot. Apparently, they had neared a deal to produce a second pilot based on Game of Thrones that was going to be from the minds of George Martin and Ryan Condal. That would focus on the Targaryen kings in the lead up to the events of the main series.
Okay. You know, again, as I said, I think we should stop with the Game of Thrones shit until George R.R. Martin finishes his books, which won't be until after Half-Life 3 is released.
I have a better, I have an update when it comes to that. It'll be done, gentlemen. Am I live? There we go. I thought I derped out for a second. But it'll be done. George R. R. Martin will be done when Vince McMahon finally fucking
be careful what you wish for.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm just saying it's probably not going to be done is what I'm trying to...
Yeah.
Right.
So, yeah. It's time to laugh at Ubisoft.
Oh,
oh my!
Oh, here we go.
You know, when I had played Breakpoint during the beta, I had suspected that this was going to backfire, even though Russian Badger managed to have some fun out of it. But I think Russian Badger and his crew can make fun out of it, can have fun with just about any game. But according to Bloomberg, Ubisoft has cut their forecast for net bookings by 1.45 billion euro. And slash their operating income by between 460 to 430 million euro to be between 20 and 50 million euro. Fucking ouch.
This isn't a rumor. Maddie, I gotta confirm my pronunciation. Yves Guillemot basically came out and said this.
Actually, no, you got it pretty much, Dan. Yeah.
Oh, there you go. When even Monsieur Gamal is saying shit's fucked up, shit's fucked up.
Yep. Yeah. And their stock price dropped 29%. Look at that.
Oof.
Damn!
That's bad.
Yeah.
Now, I will say, The Division 2 isn't a bad game, but they have had a hard time keeping up regarding content, and subscribers have gone down significantly for that.
Yeah. And I think all the turmoil in Ubisoft is probably to blame.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It probably has to do with the fact that they had too many eggs in one basket.
Yeah. Yeah, it's just AAA gaming and gone wrong again. And you know what? I think this is a good time for me to talk about this a little, you know? Now, for years, I've been saying that the video game crash is coming. The video game crash is coming, and it's largely going to affect the Western gaming industry. I'm going to get this situation with Ubisoft. I'm going to say this right now. This is the Western video gaming industry's version of Lehman Brothers. Okay? if because I think the shit is going to hit the fan in the next few years. Mm-hmm. Because here's the deal. They're going to release their next gen consoles next year. Pretty much ballparking.
Right.
Now, here's what they're going to do for the first couple years. They're going to do the same thing they did when the current generation came out. What did they do between the release in around 2013 and holiday 2015? What did they do, you gentlemen?
Mm-hmm.
Punt.
They did not release jack shit. And by jack shit, they meant any significant titles. We'll still get our Madden and FIFA every fucking year, but they didn't release anything significant.
Yeah.
So they're gonna pull this shit again. Cause they're already promoting shit coming out in 2021, 2022. And I think this year, I think spring 2020 is going to be sort of like the point of no return. Because after this shit, we're going to have a dry spell for about a year or two. I'm going to guarantee you that. They pulled this shit with the launch of the PS4 and the Xbox One. And like Miltra told me earlier, they're not going to get away with it this time. Because, again, these AAA companies have, for the last 2 to 3 years, have been tripping over themselves. Mm-hmm. It's run by idiots. The Japanese are whooping their ass. Mm-hmm. And it seems like it's been problem after problem after problem after problem after problem. And now you're going to just pull this 2 years... Here's Shomer Shabbos on this shit like you did before. You're gonna go down.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and
I'm gonna say this right now. I keep saying the crash is coming. With this, I'm gonna say this right now. The crash is here.
I've mentioned this before. I think people are way too gung ho about a crash. About mm-hmm. mostly because I don't, because they think that's going to just wipe out the AAA issue. Things are working in a slow process on that. And given the next story, I think that Ubisoft is definitely in panic mode because they know that they're the smoke signal.
Let me clarify, Mildra. I'm not talking like an 80. This is going to be like 83, where it's going to be bam, gone. We're talking slow moving train wreck.
I maintain that what you are going to see is a crunch.
Mm-hmm.
But moving past that, they're now starting to ask devs to pitch games' uniqueness after Breakpoint ended up bombing.
Good luck with their staff. You're better off asking for outside help.
So because the thing that really caused the stock to drop was the fact that Watch Dogs Legion, Gods and Monsters, and Ghost Recon Quarantine have been delayed until late 2020.
And like I said, I think the problem is the story was too much in the bubble, especially with Watch Dogs. That just turned when they decided to go woke. It turned me off.
I will admit that Watch Dogs Legion looks promising, and I'd rather them delay it than rush it out.
Yeah.
How much of a
whatever we've done the story is going to be?
I'm not entirely sure yet, and I didn't play Watch Dogs 2.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I played Watch Dogs 2. It's really good. But here's the thing what they should have done with Legion. Don't even talk about fucking Brexit, okay? You know what? You know who you should talk about for Watch Dogs Legion? Don't blame Brexit. Go for the big enemy throughout the entire your series. Bloom.
Mm-hmm.
Because for those of you who don't play Watch Dogs, Bloom is basically the series version of Abstergo.
Ah.
Think Google, but worse.
Well, I think that's the big problem that Ubisoft has is that too many of their games have bled into each other. And this is a problem for a while. But the fact that they're changing their mentality, saying, quote, now it's about how you have to pitch your game as being super unique, having some unique aspect to it. I can't confirm whether or not that's actually the case because I'm getting that third hand. But
listen, here's the deal. I'll tell you what, Monsieur Gamal, if you want someone to fix your shit, give you some decent ideas, you know where to reach me.
I'm just gonna put this out there, Ubisoft. You still have the Rayman IP. Rayman Legends was really fucking good. Child of Light was really damn good.
And those Raving Rabbids games, especially the TV one for the Wii, was fairly decent.
You managed to make Mario meets XCOM with your little collab with Nintendo.
Mm-hmm. Which is pretty good.
You've got plenty of options. You're just not willing to use them because you want to focus on all the money making. Well,
basically, Monsieur Gamal, you're Matt Nagy.
All right, and hang on.
He's not wrong, Monk. He's not wrong.
I'm gonna be. I'm just gonna say I know who that is and move on.
You sound probably tired there, Zeltrax.
I'm struggling here.
Go to sleep.
Yeah.
Don't worry about it, man.
Don't burn yourself out. Yeah.
But
not obligated to be here.
Yeah.
All right.
I think now is a good enough time to, you know, if I had the music, I would ask someone to play Cone Susser Todd, because we need an appropriate song for the demise of Kotaku.
There we go.
Oh yeah, here we go.
By the way, I was told you played that particular song. You were switching for your fight, looking for approval of.
Mm-hmm.
The thumb is up.
Hold on a second. Yeah, I didn't feel. Play this. I'm pretty sure everybody's heard Baby Shark enough times, so I decided to go with something a bit more apropos.
I told them, don't play Baby Shark. That's how people get stabbed in the eyes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay, here we go. Yeah. I've never heard of this song, but you know what? Fuck it. Yeah, burn in hell.
Actually,
cut it.
Yeah,
cut it, because I got something better. And Natty, you're gonna appreciate this. So, looking at this article, looking at this tweet, and seeing the statement about what's going on here, simply put, a number of people over at Deadspin are leaving. They're getting the fuck out. Mm-hmm. What I say to that?
Yes!
There's a classic.
Okay, here's the deal. You know,
let me set the stage first.
Go for it.
So, GO Media, which is the parent company of Kotaku, Lifehacker, Deadspin, Jezebel, and so on, is losing money big time. Now, I know some of you are probably want me to cover the auto roll video ads. That's a smokescreen. We're not covering that.
No.
What we are going to cover is the fact that Deadspin was given a memo and told, stick to sports. We have people in other departments who can cover more political matters. Their union, known as GMG, decided to issue the following statement. And Shades, do you think you could do this one in the smug voice?
Oh, absolutely. Ooh,
we need smug just, Shades. We do yes. need that. Yeah.
I can give you smug Shades. Don't worry. Today, a number of our colleagues at Deadspin resigned from their positions. From
too
the
smug.
No, hold up. Let's see if I still have that. Ah, here we go. All right. Okay, I'll try. Okay. Let's go ahead.
From the outset, CEO Tim Spanfeller has worked to undermine a successful site by curtailing its most well-read coverage because it makes him personally uncomfortable. This is not what journalism looks like, and it is not what editorial independence looks like. Stick to Sports is and always has been a thinly veiled euphemism for don't speak truth to power. In addition to being bad business, Spanfeller's actions are morally reprehensible. The GMG Union stands with our current and former Deadspin colleagues and condemns Jim Spanfeller in the strongest possible terms.
Have you ever heard, GMG Union, I want to ask you a question. Have you ever heard of the expression, don't bite the hand that feeds you?
Yep.
Exactly.
Because here's the thing. Your whole speak truth to power for a sports blog, one that decided at one point to employ the most hated kicker in the NFL, and the guy who couldn't hold a conversation with Mercedes.
Mm-hmm. By the way, free Mercedes.
Yep.
Yes.
Hashtag free for Mercedes.
Yeah.
That stuff is not generating impressions, is not generating enough traffic to keep the lights on. And it's especially the case because you decided to unionize and argue that you should be paid $50,000 a year to write your shit, which I think is vastly overpriced.
Jesus.
What you're getting paid is good enough, you jag.
And when the Deadspin guys ended up getting fired, a lot of the folks at Kotaku and some of the other places were getting very, very worried that they might get axed next.
Well, here's the well, you know what? Before you do that, here's the response to this shit.
What you just said is one of the most insanely idiotic things I have ever heard. At no point in your rambling, incoherent response were you even close to anything that could be considered a rational thought. Everyone in this room is now dumber for having listened to it. I award you no points, and may God have mercy on your soul.
And of course, the first comment we see is from Rodrigo Yabanez, who decided to do the double dance of Joker dancing on the Bronx steps along with Funky Peter.
Yes!
Because remember, with great funk comes great responsibility.
Yes!
Yes! I know, the only people we know of who got this stay in your lane memo is Deadspin, but I have a sneaking suspicion that this was not just them. I think every site in GeoMedia's umbrella got that memo.
Yeah, not only that. Yeah, and
yeah,
of course,
more than likely.
It's my turn to share a conspiracy theory. Let me adjust my tinfoil hat for a second. Here we go. All right. And I think it was alluded to by another show. I forgot who made this, but it's sound. Maybe, here's the deal. The guys at GeoMedia, probably when they bought this, they knew, okay, we got to make money somehow, and this isn't making us money. The question is, so how are we going to make us money? Well, we need to get rid of all these woke assholes. Now, the thing is, we can't lay them off because we have to pay them, right? So they figured out something, another way to get rid of them without having to pay them a red cent. Get them to quit. And how do you do that?
Oh, go ahead.
Stop them from, basically send a memo saying, stop writing your woke shit and stick to the topic at hand. Which you know they're not going to do.
I think, here's my take. Here's what I think went down. I think the thing that we covered last week with Huffington Post started setting off alarm bells. Because if Huffington Post, which was one of the big deals for several years, especially during the Bush years, if they're looking for a buyer, I'm pretty sure the investors at Geo Media are thinking, how long is it until we're under the same axe? Because I guarantee they're looking at that. They're looking at the fact that Disney's investment in Vox is being written off as dead money, and that was like $200 million they invested in Vox. They're looking at what happened with Fusion. They're looking at what happened with a few other places, and they're saying we don't want to be on that list. We need to do something about this, because they probably picked the thing up thinking that they could somehow tame it. That's not going to happen. The only way you can really fix the sites under Geo's umbrella is
get rid of the cancer.
Unfortunately, some healthy tissue has to get cut out if you're cutting out cancer. Case in point, the Pittsburgh Steelers.
No. Yep.
Further case in point, the Tampa Bay Lightning.
Oh boy. And of course, among these idiots, Cryer.
Cryer decided he did not take kindly to the fact that people were telling him to learn to code. And he decided to claim all the people who were saying that, including Mark Kern and myself, are alt-right.
Citation needed, asshole.
So apparently this is an alt-right podcast. I didn't know that at that point, but sorry to drop a bombshell on you guys.
Wait, I'm alt-right? Oh, I am so fun.
Yeah. But like I said, you know what? No sympathy to these idiots. And you know what? Additionally, and I read this, and this is, and I listened further about this from Tim Pool, that it turns out someone else tried to hire someone else, and they basically harassed them. And he was forced to quit. They thought, oh, we're going to salt the earth. So you know what they did? They hired a few more people at 40K as well. They say, hey, you want to come right for our shit? Said, fuck yeah. But the thing is, they'll get paid their money, but their name won't be on the byline to protect their identity. So you know what, you dumbass motherfuckers? There's one... Hold on, let me find this shit. Here you go.
Congratulations, you played yourself.
Yes.
I just love it when karma comes bite someone in the ass.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Because of that, nobody...
No, boys, I have work for a little bit, so good night.
All right.
Good night, Maddie. Yeah. I'll see you next time.
Good night, man.
Yep.
But you know what? Yeah. But you know what? Like I said, no fucking simpy. Learn to code, you jagoffs.
Mm-hmm.
But now, with that out of the way, it is time we get to some of the goodies.
Oh, yes.
Because initially, I thought I was only going to have 3 out of 4 this week. Fuck I know.
Oh, boy. Hold on. I gotta find the thing. All right.
Because we have a full quartet. And we start off with the newest version of our unholy quartet, the thing that made it an unholy quartet instead of a trinity.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
One life, 2K.
All right. Butterfield for Frezel, Nick. Rosetta Stone French, motherfucker. I don't know if I pronounced it right.
I'll clip it and I'll give a timestamp and I'll ask Maddie tomorrow. Yeah. But yeah. I had now the One Life 2K instance is brief this week, but it did happen. And it had and we're talking about NBA 2K20 again.
Oh god.
Oh Jesus.
Because you know those unskippable ads we bitched about last year's game?
Mao is back. Get out of here.
Yeah.
So they've started putting in ads that are interrupting gameplay and can't be skipped by normal means, which means the player has to sit right the fuck through them.
Oh yep. Boy. Yep. That is some bullshit.
and we have a streamer, Brutalism the Guru, who's showing one of them, is playing right in the middle of a fucking loading screen.
Dumb.
Yeah.
So yeah. Once again, they pulled this shit.
Yeah.
I knew they were gonna pull something stupid.
It's 2K. Of course they are gonna do that.
Of course.
My approach is to say our expectations were low, but holy fuck.
Yeah. No, I got the button for this.
I expect nothing, and I'm still let down.
I was about to say that.
But then we have the big one, and because of what happened over the weekend, there is no way I'm not paying attention to this. Ladies and gentlemen, break out your Muppets. Asshats of Activision.
Phenomena.
Activision sucks.
Thanks.
Got it.
Oh, Marussia.
So
yeah.
Now they're getting review bombed for Russian representation with the Modern Warfare reboot. Now, normally, I would have thought that this was just a case of NPCs crying, but there is a small degree of legitimacy to this. I have to thank Upper Echelon Games for bringing this up. In one of the chapters, one thing that's brought up is the Highway of Death, which they claim a lot of the death that happened in that thing was due to the Russians. That is not the case. It was actually done by the Americans.
Right.
And what people are getting the negative reviews are
oh, well, hold up, let me interrupt. I think the Nick Folk curse has struck.
Yeah,
beat New England 37-20.
Yep.
The curse of Nick Folk never fails.
Never.
Anyway,
Nick Folk, I would rather run Curse of Strahd at D&D 5th edition than have you as my kicker. Put your motherfucking head back down.
Hold on.
Put your motherfucking head back down.
Oh, and Green Bay lost to the Chargers.
Anyway.
Continue, it's Green Bay, over. So fuck them.
Yeah, continue, Milter.
So the issue that's been had from Russian players is their country being used as a villain. And one of the things that Upper Echelon brought up is that they ended up being being the villain because of convenience. Because if they went with any sort of jihadi, then the woke police would end up getting on their case, is what Upper Echelon is claiming.
Personally, as far as Upper Echelon, you know what, Upper Echelon, fuck them. You should have just done what you were originally supposed to do anyway.
That's what Echelon was saying as far as his theory on the matter. He is mixed on the matter too, but apparently it's gotten so bad that it's been pulled from the PS store in Russia. That was only the taster, and this is not the last time that we'll be dealing with dealing with modern warfare.
Mm-hmm.
Oh boy.
So next is a leak regarding Overwatch 2, which was announced,
yes.
but with no release date.
It's
although
time to deal with the nuclear winter.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
So a leak by Metro is suggesting that progress players have made so far will not carry over. So progression, skins, all that kind of stuff won't carry over. People will have to start from scratch.
Mm-hmm.
Now, apparently, the Overwatch 2 thing will be having a new leveling system, PvE and PvP, which is something that should have been in the first game.
Yeah, really.
Yes.
And that the change to skins will make people upset. No shit.
Mm-hmm.
He tweeted saying, currently there are no plans to be able to transfer items or progress from Overwatch 1 to 2. Please don't take this as a fact. I think if Blizzard changes one thing, it should be this. Again, this is current plans and hopefully not set in stone.
Yeah, but then again, fuck Blizzard.
Yeah.
Which, I'm not going to say that's a confirmation because, again, this is a fluid situation. And Kira's saying the leak was a lie. I said take it with a grain of salt.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But this was not a lie. Mitsubishi bailed on Blizzard 2 days after the Blitzchung incident.
We all know the Japanese aren't fans of the Chinese.
Nope.
Of course they bailed on them.
Mm-hmm.
They, fuck you, Chinese!
And apparently some sponsors are sticking with them, but this pull off is certainly going to make some waves. Although I do like this little thing. So Mitsubishi was involved in gaming sponsorships, and Shay says he's great in Soul Calibur.
You think of Yoshimitsu?
Yeah,
no, Mitsurugi.
Mitsurugi.
But then there was this little instance for the 15th anniversary, crowdfunding their esports.
Oh, for God's sake!
Drink for fucking esports.
Fuck esports.
Now, if they had done it where this was going to charity, I wouldn't mind it. But the idea that these skins and emotes are going to the prize pool for their 15th anniversary esports event. It's a case of, why do you need to crowdfund? You're fucking Blizzard.
Yeah.
Unless there's money prowls we don't know.
Which I have a hard time believing there is, given that BlizzCon is still a thing.
Yeah. But you know what? It's sort of another case of this.
Don't ask questions. Just consume product and then get excited for next product.
Exactly.
And then there was the whole thing about Shadowlands being the next WoW expansion, which is a bit late and gay because we already know that's going to be the case.
Uh-huh.
And then we have President J. Allen Brack doing a "We're sorry."
Yeah, this nitwit. Yeah.
So just prior to BlizzCon, President J. Allen Brack addressed the crowd and apologized for how the Blitzchung controversy was handled, saying, "We moved too quickly and were too slow to talk with all of you." What the fuck does moving fast or slow have anything to do with what you did?
Either fast or slow, you still fucked up.
Mm-hmm. If you had stated no politics during the thing. Here's the other thing. He's saying that they don't want politics during the thing while he was wearing
a fucking pride pin.
Yeah.
You idiot.
But I don't want to focus too much on what happened at BlizzCon, and
he's a hostage.
Yeah. So, Brack, blink twice if somebody's aiming a gun at you.
Right.
This is a case of sorry, he got caught.
I would not be surprised if the Chinese MSS had a rifleman there.
Mm-hmm. Neither would I.
But the idea of high standards, given the fact that you had to have China twist your arm in order to start putting out odds for your loot boxes in Overwatch.
Jesus
don't bullshit Christ. Me, man.
Yeah.
I got my leg telling me it's raining. What are you thinking there? Are you a fucking reject from the 90s? I swear to God, he looks like one of Pearl Jam's ex-guitarists.
I get a damn haircut.
Yeah.
But of course, judging from the videos I've seen on the matter, nobody is buying this.
Nope. Mm-hmm. Even the Diablo 4 distractions isn't working. Hell, even this tactic isn't working.
Don't ask questions. Just consume product and then get excited for next product.
What I want to highlight at BlizzCon is that first off, the protests did happen outside of the place, and they were, according to my reports, they were very respectable. They didn't try and start any shit. They just protested, held their signs, would talk to anybody who came up and asked, and were handing out T-shirts.
The fucking mad lads there. All we're missing right now is a couple people in Pooh Bear costumes, Naruto running.
No, but we did get the Pooh. Not only did we get the Pooh Bear costumes, we got the red shirts, and we got people saying "Liberate Hong Kong" in the fucking Q&A.
Yeah, and I think Blizzard realizes they were in a no-win situation. If they try to squash it would look worse for them. So at this point, they're like, okay, let it happen. Get out of your system, you assholes.
And to be fair, I kind of feel bad for the people who are sitting at the Q&A.
Yeah.
Because they didn't ask for any of this. They were just probably working on Shadowlands while all this was going on.
Yeah, they were thrown to the wolves. Welcome back, Dooku.
Give him a minute.
Nah, continue.
But the last bit that we have regard it brings us back to Modern Warfare, and that is the fact that Xbox One users are having some problems.
What reason? 533 why don't touch consoles.
Let's see. Website Multiplayer First has put up a piece on Modern Warfare causing Xbox One consoles to shut down or face unpleasant scenarios.
Oh, boy.
Apparently, in some cases, shutdowns. In other cases, crashes. Some people are getting a little bit paranoid to the point where they're refusing to play the game until this gets fixed because they don't want their shit getting bricked.
Oh, yeah. There's one of them put it, his name is Centris equals rebranded SJWs, said, "You buy cock a duty? You deserve more than just a console shutdown."
I feel bad about dunking on Call of Duty with at least with this version, because we had given praise to the fact that Taylor Kurosaki did not bend the knee.
Yeah, he did okay, but it's just more dumb shit.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, plot twist. This ain't a glitch. That's a marketing ploy to lure peasants to buy their exclusive Soy Station content.
Pretty much!
Mm-hmm. Again, why don't touch consoles?
I'm blaming this particular thing on poor optimization.
Yeah.
Especially since I've been getting reports of optimization problems with the Outer Worlds on PC.
Ooh, I wonder why that is the case.
It'll probably get patched out in the coming weeks. But I know where you're going with that, but I don't think that's particularly the fault of Epic. Although from what I've heard, the console versions are having similar problems and some worse.
But okay.
Moving past that, it is time for the third part of the Unholy Quartet. EA, egregious assholes.
Okay, gang. What you fuck up this time?
Yeah.
So, in the first bit of it, we have the fact that EA and DICE are planning to ship another Battlefield in fiscal year 2022.
Wait a minute. Wasn't I harping about something along the lines of that? This is the first of many titles that they're going to give the holiday 2015 treatment to.
Yeah.
Oof. Again, this is going to backfire.
Now, that's the year that starts in April 2021 and ends March 2022.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Now, as far as whether or not this is going to be Battlefield 6 or a completely different name is unknown. In fact, we don't know anything about what this future Battlefield will look like. But all I have to say in lieu of that is, anybody who's pissed off about Battlefield, go play Hell Let Loose. You'll have a lot more fun.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's still an early access, but they're working on the game. It is a very dedicated affair, and it's a much better World War II experience.
Yeah, like I said, folks, don't just boycott. Play their competitors.
Yeah.
All right, and next, now, we covered this last week, but at the time, it was just a heavily implied rumor. Now it's alt-right confirmed. EA Games and EA Access and possibly some of the Origin stuff is coming to Steam.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
They've set up a partnership. The first game that's going to be part of that partnership is Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order. And
of course.
The problem is they fucked it up.
Of course.
Of course, because it's EA. They don't know how to. They don't know shit these days.
I have been getting.
Yeah.
I have been getting conflicting reports on this matter, so take this with a grain of salt. But there are some people who are saying you're still going to need Origin to do updates, and others who are saying you do not.
The gang fucks up their transition.
But
yeah.
But in addition, you may or may not need Origin regarding Jedi Fallen Order. I don't know if this is 100% the case. So again, big ass grain of salt. But this is an interesting remark. And as Sid Alpha pointed out, they have been made acutely aware about how their bad PR is affecting business. And I think them trying to move back into Steam is their attempt to try and salvage PR.
Definitely.
Unfortunately, they can't just shut down Origin because they've got it grandfathered in. And if they shut down Origin, they're going to have other people pissed off.
Oh yeah.
But the last the next but next it's time to take a few shots at the continuing folly.
Oh yeah.
Oh, definitely.
So they're also punting to 2022. And as far as any attempt at a new Dragon Age game, I'm not acting all that shocked that they're punting again. Simply because of the fact that they barely made any talk about what this new Dragon Age is going to be.
Number two. Again, as like I said, they're EA. They're basically at this point. They're just throwing up their hands and going dark for the next couple years.
Mm-hmm.
Just relying on Madden and FIFA. That's about it. That's what they can do right now.
But
yeah,
I will freely admit I have, unless they decided to not use Frostbite for a future Dragon Age, I have no confidence.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, and like I said earlier. This strategy is going to backfire.
Oh, definitely.
Because now you got, because despite the fact that gaming industry right now is expensive to make and leveraged out the ass, you're still going to have indies releasing titles and basically taking all their fucking market share. This is not a good idea.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have, who else left BioWare? In this case, Chad Robertson.
Gone.
Halloween night was his last week with BioWare.
Oh my God.
After being with the company for 14 years.
I don't think they're going to make it to 2022.
Jesus. Well, BioWare is about to become the next victim of the EA grinder.
Yep. You've seen that movie Casino? Well, they just dug up grave in the cornfield.
Mm-hmm.
pretty much. And while doing this, they keep insisting that Anthem is fine. There's no problems. But when you see so many people coming and going through that studio, is it really?
Nothing to see here. Please disperse.
In fact, if I had the clip, I would play the panic button from MST3K.
Yeah.
In fact, let me see if I can get that. I will post up. Oh, found it. I will post this in the council for you guys.
Yeah, boy. Oh yeah, I remember this.
Yeah.
This is when Joel hit the left.
Uh-huh.
Can one of you play that?
Yeah, I can probably give a shot.
Carbonation.
Yep. Okay, so... Of course, it's going to take me a while, so keep going.
Mm-hmm. And yeah, we have one person saying, jump, the ship is sinking.
Yep.
He goes on to say, I join as a fan now and look forward to playing BioWare games for years to come.
Yep. Yeah, again, yeah, those years might be pretty fucking short. Again, with everybody jumping this sinking ship, I don't think they're going to make it to 2022.
Right.
So you know what? Well, tough titties, kids.
See, we have one person going, best of luck in all your future endeavors and all but BioWare in good hands. Great things ahead. I don't believe you.
Yeah. I wish you all the best luck in your future endeavors. Try to get the John Laurinaitis voice.
Right.
Yeah, so a lot of people are saying good luck, and a lot of people are going, what hands? These hands? There's my one.
Boy.
But as if to prove your
point.
That is the perfect representation of BioWare Edmonton right now.
Yep.
And just to allow me to destroy any hope and optimism you had about Battlefield 6. Yes, it will be on next-gen consoles, and it will be driven by live service mechanics.
Fucking course.
Drink!
Yeah, straight for live services.
I didn't have any plans on getting another Battlefield anytime soon anyways. And at this point, I would just say if you still have it, go play 2.
Uh-oh, looks like Mitt Romney had some comments. Here's his question. So that resource constraints, I'll say that up front, but it was a very thought through decision for us. It was blah 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 blah. It sounds like I can't read this. Mm-hmm. It's so much cliches, too much flowery language. I swear to God.
Honestly,
keep it you fool.
Every time I read it, I feel like I need to have the voice of God from Monty Python, the Holy Grail.
Get on with it.
Hold on. I got that button. I got that button actually. Yeah. Where's that? Where is that button? Okay, I thought do I not have it saved? I'll get it later.
Yeah, anyway, but yeah. Andrew Wilson being milquetoast Andrew Wilson yet again.
Yeah.
And now for the original soap opera. The one that just works. The one,
yes.
The only... The Bold and the Bitch Thesda. And just when it's funny that you talked about a civil war earlier on, Aaron, because Fallout 76 is in the middle of a civil war.
So, oh boy. Yeah.
anybody who ends up actually getting the stuff out of Fallout first is getting griefed and teabagged by other players.
Yeah, and rightly so.
Yeah. Rightful. Yeah, definitely.
But first, so they were they decided to do a Halloween event, and in true Bethesda fashion, it's broken.
Yep. Looks like we got the trick.
So we're having persistent server crashes, textures disappearing, dying at the wrong time, and being unable to respawn for the duration of the event. That only occurs during the tail end of the event against a legendary sentry bot. But because of that, people end up losing out on drops as a result, the reason why they do these kind of events.
Yep, coincidentally, all trick, no treat.
And this is one of those cases where I have to put on my tinfoil hat. There is vastly better performance being reported for people who are running private servers.
Of fucking course. I'm sure that's true.
And apparently the events drops still are not as good as the stuff that's coming out of the Atom store.
Oh boy.
So once again, can Bethesda, can you do anything right, or am I going to be haunted by the ghost of the mop for all eternity?
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, it gets better.
Yep.
But wait, it gets better.
Their parent company, ZeniMax, has been forced to refund Australians by the ACCC, or the Australian Competition and Consumer Commission.
Oh! Now you fucked up! Now you fucked up! Now you fucked up! You have fucked up now! Now you fucked up! Now you fucked up! Now you fucked up! Now you fucked up!
The ACCC, I'm just going to call it the AC3, has accepted a court enforceable undertaking from three related video gaming companies after they acknowledged they were likely to have misled consumers about their consumer guarantee rights in relation to Fallout 76. The companies are ZeniMax Media Incorporated, ZeniMax Media Limited, and ZeniMax Australia Party Limited. Together, ZeniMax accepted that their actions likely have contravened against Australian consumer law.
Ooh,
the AC3 received complaints from that ZeniMax representatives told customers that they were not entitled to a refund after they had experienced a variety of faults within Fallout 76, including, in some cases, problems with the servers, lagging, graphic and visual problems. Quote, ZeniMax has acknowledged they are likely to have misled certain Australian consumers about their rights to refund when they experienced faults with the Fallout 76 game, Commissioner Sarah Court said. ZeniMax will offer to provide refunds to consumers who have contacted them between November 24th, 2018 and June 1st, 2019 to request a refund if they have not already received one. Customers who receive a refund will no longer be entitled to access and play the game. When a customer buys a product, it comes with an automatic consumer guarantees, and retailers must ensure that their refunds and returns policies do not misrepresent what the AC3 provides, Ms. Court said. When a consumer has purchased a product that has fault, which amounts to a major failure, the Australian consumer law provides them with the right to ask for their choice of either repair, replacement, or refund. Now, repair is obviously out of the question because it's a digital purchase, and it's software.
Replacement, good luck.
Replacement, you just be replacing one shit with another shit because it's off because the problem isn't on the disc itself or on the download itself. So the only thing they can do is refunds.
Oops.
They have also undertaken to amend its customer service documents and scripts to address the AC3's concerns about misrepresentation of the consumer guarantee rights under the ACL.
Oh, boy.
And we're already getting reports that, they managed to get... Some people are getting their refunds.
Oh boy, this. You might as well just pack it in Bethesda, fucking mm-hmm. because this game is cursed.
Oh yeah.
So I gotta say, I know that in a few years you're gonna be making the E3 rounds and going to E3, Gamescom, maybe TGS, and hopefully not doing Bethesda Land 2.0 because God, that was a dumb idea.
Oh God.
But you're probably gonna be promoting Starfield and possibly The Elder Scrolls 6, and to that all I have to say is, good luck.
You'll need it.
Mm-hmm. But then there. Oh, now, God. For this last thing, I will freely admit, this is not confirmed, and this is coming to us from a leaker, and it looks like he had another update in November. What does that say?
Oh, this one. Yeah, I saw this.
Yeah. Now, the whole notion that Fallout 4 subscriptions are exceeding expectations. That I have to call into doubt, because if it really was a success, they would be putting out press releases for it. Mm-hmm. And they say, especially the 1 month sub statistics. That I could see, but the thing about that sort of thing, and this is the reason why just bringing up a statistics without context is a bad move. How do we know that people aren't just buying for a month and then not retaining? It is, you've only announced this thing for about a week and a half.
Yeah.
That is way too early to say whether or not this is a success.
Mm-hmm.
Now, apparently they're also saying that more utility items may be coming to Fallout first, along with some sort of subscriber rewards program. Crossplay was brought up, but shut down internally. I didn't think that was ever going to happen.
No.
As far as PC being the culprit, I don't see why PC would be the culprit for not allowing crossplay. I'd say consoles would be the bigger problem, honestly.
Yeah.
Apparently, they're told not to expect crossplay of any kind unless the community really pushes for it. It will be missing its 2019 Steam debut, which was supposed to occur with the launch of Wastelanders. so that's one more fuck up for the pile.
Yeah.
And then, so apparently Fallout First, according to our leaker MMOG Fails, Fallout First players aren't getting all the new items for free. They have to pay using the items they get from the subscription. Almost like a first one's free line that you would hear from a drug dealer.
Mm-hmm.
He says that he can't deal with the anger, and he's taking a break. Understandable. So apparently not all new things will be given to Fallout First members free of charge. There will be Fallout First exclusive items that you have to spend atoms on. Is this redundant?
Yeah.
But this exclusive items for Fallout First purchasers. You know, it really has become Fallout Fuck You First.
Yeah,
pretty much.
They're even discussing a try it first thing. And apparently he also goes into a internal memo going around Bethesda condemning this site and other YouTubers for fanning the flames.
Oh. Okay.
Jesus Christ.
I would like to think that even Todd is not that stupid to have a memo put out in his company that they should be trying to discredit YouTubers, because
I wouldn't put it past the Hobbit.
Well, if you want to pick a fight with YouTubers, have fun with that.
Good luck, buddy. Yeah,
seriously.
Mm-hmm.
Because we all saw what happened the last time. We also what happened the last time a game company decided to take shots at YouTubers.
Yeah.
It did not end well.
Mm-hmm. No.
But beyond that, initially I thought I wasn't going to have a main event, and then a little thing from Arch came to my attention.
Oh, boy.
Kontogan, play us in.
Oh boy. You know what, gentlemen? We haven't seen it all night, but you know what? I see a train coming.
Yeah. All aboard!
Oh my god!
So, Games Workshop has stated that they are pursuing multimedia projects for specifically animated and film projects for Warhammer 40,000. In a similar vein to Asmodee launching an entertainment division and Watsy having movies on D&D and Magic the Gathering in development.
Oh my god.
Oh Jesus.
Let's see here. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Oh, how lovely. They managed this. They mentioned the Satanic Panic.
Yeah.
Good god. No fucking self-awareness here.
No.
But they try and open their argument by saying that Warhammer 40,000 is problematic. And of course they bring up the whole Satanic Panic. But why bring that up?
Yeah,
especially they're trying to argue that it's because 40K is not a good versus evil story. And okay, here's where I have to go. What the fuck? In the eyes of many pop culture fans, who the hell is a pop culture fan? 40K not only glorifies being the bad guy, it rationalizes evil.
Oh, fucking drink.
Hang on.
Drink. Yeah.
I wasn't able to go through the whole Toku memes shades, but how high did the botch counter go?
What, today?
Yeah, how high did the typo counter go?
Just the one meme.
Because we got another typo. It rationalizes evil, so...
Yeah.
Do I hear two?
He goes, Sci-fi fans call 40K setting grimdark because, well, it is. The whole, in the grim darkness of the future, there is only war. Saying the game was a child of 80s death metal sensibilities. I'm not entirely sure about that.
They're basically using the same tactic that the idiots during the Satanic Panic did. That is some bullshit, and you know what? Drink.
Yeah, sure. Now,
if you want to say 80s, I think you would have a better if you're going to use metal for this, you'd have a better argument of using British new wave.
Yeah, new wave. Yeah, fucking Judas Priest or some shit.
Especially both of that and Heavy Metal Magazine, because you have to keep in mind GW is a UK company.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
And a lot of their early artwork, like what we see here, which I think that image is from Rogue Trader. Here's the problem. Using early 40K as a reflection of modern 40K is a bad idea, because originally it was kind of done in a parody like style. But after, I'd want to say, third edition of the war game, then it started to go into the more serious, more grimdark style that we know of today.
Yeah.
But you look at this artwork, and would this be out of place in 2000 AD?
Oh, no. This reminds me of 2000 AD.
And that's that's kind of that. So you have a bit of an idea of what they were going with.
Yeah, this is sort of like early 80s British art style.
And then he goes on to talk about how miniature wargaming was a niche hobby. It's still a niche hobby. It's still a particular type of hobbyist. It was a small property that existed in a different social and political climate. It's a fucking game.
Good.
Yeah. Everything's got to be Nintendo for you assholes.
Current year. Fuck you. Drink.
And then you go, consider the central character and government founded, the God Emperor and the Imperium of Man. Big E is not the central character.
Yeah.
There is no central character with 40K because it's a setting. I had to have this argument when I had a discussion with somebody about Project Gaia. I am not writing a story in the traditional sense. I am writing a setting.
This is basically this is basically in the same narrative style as fucking BattleTech /MechWarrior.
Actually, yeah. it's just BattleTech if we're talking about the core miniatures game. Okay. The Imperium is a fascist dictatorship steeped in religious fanaticism. Yes, it is.
Okay.
And?
Yeah. And? It's fictitious.
It's supposed to be the point of view faction that the game's in the game setting, the good guys. No, it isn't.
Nope.
Name me one piece of fiction, whether it be the books, the RPG, the miniatures game, or the Black Library novels, or anything out of Forge World that claims that the Imperium of Man are the good guys.
In fact, there's hardly any good guys in 40K, aren't they?
No.
Yeah.
And even the closest to good guys aren't all that good.
Yeah, it's pretty much a crap sack world.
Yep. Then you say, on top of that, there's no rebellion resisting this regime. Bullshit! If that were the case, why would the Inquisition be a thing? And they bring up, like in Star Wars. Oh, I see what you're going. You want 40K to be like Star Wars.
Nope!
Of course!
Nope! Yeah, get out of here, you moron. Jesus.
The Imperium is the most hellish dystopia in fiction, but it's presented as right. No, it isn't.
Nope.
It's depicted as we are fighting to survive against a galaxy that hates us. Because the galaxy in 40K is not a safe place to be.
No.
Which leads us to the Emperor, he says, whose image was co-opted by
Gamergate
dickbags.
Drake!
To them, the Emperor embodies real American ideals. They call Trump the God Emperor and place his face on the character's armored body. That was a fucking meme.
Here come the train again.
All aboard!
Oh my god!
Although I gotta say the COVID limousines I see here.
Nice.
Although when I see these two vehicles, all I'm thinking of is got half a tank of gas, have a pack of cigarettes, 40 miles to Chicago. It's dark and we're wearing sunglasses.
Oh boy, and the Illinois Nazis are right behind us.
I hate Illinois Nazis.
Yeah.
The game's first edition was so gonzo and over the top that it was considered a parody of sci-fi awesomeness, like StarCraft meets Metalocalypse.
Because it was a
over the years, Games Workshop cleaned it up. Technically, gone are the heavy metal trappings and ludicrous elements. 40K retains all the totalitarianism, xenophobia, and religious fundamentalism,
with none of the insanity that makes it interesting.
Bullshit.
Drink.
Yeah, drink.
Straw man after straw man.
Does this guy even play?
Yeah. Goes, I don't play, and I know that's not what the game's about, you jerk-offs. Goes,
even the orcs are less fun. Bullshit! You talking about the boys? You talk about the boys, you get chopped, you get...
God damn it.
And also... Shades, Aaron, Flutter?
Yes?
How much DACA is enough DACA?
Never enough!
Without weaponized electric guitars and space limousines, the 40K universe isn't metal anymore. It's just mean. Let me introduce you to the Noise Marines.
Yes. Oh, the gloriousness of the Noise Marines.
Yep. Hundreds of novels chronicle the fictional history of the 40K universe. Even if they rebooted the entire setting, there's still Wikipedia and two dedicated fan wikis and 1D4chan. Don't even be talking shit about 1D4chan.
Oh, God.
You gonna talk shit about TG? We get more shit done than you do, motherfucker.
Yeah, really.
And thousands of websites, including some ancient sites from a time before social media. Ancient?
Oh, you freaking moron. This is the part where I start throwing the screwdriver at him.
Yeah.
Because, and they all showcase 40K's very violent and very politically incorrect legacy.
So?
GW's kid-friendly...
It's nothing you like, so fuck you!
GW's kid-friendly exactly. Warhammer Adventures aren't going to help much. Nobody likes Warhammer Adventures.
No!
No!
Everybody was saying this was a bad idea from day one. And if it's to expand the audience... Down. For those who have read that particular story, or heard me do a summation, or heard me, or Arch, or Chaptermaster Valeric, or anybody else do a summation of the thing. Imagine if somebody reads Warhammer Adventures and then reads one of the Black Library novels. Like, say, I don't know, Cornate Knights or The First Heretic.
Oh, boy.
Or any of the stories involving Hanzo and the Demon Kulaba that he made. Which, I am not going to show the Demon Kulaba because there's a significant lack of skin.
Oh.
It's like, we need to reinforce our soldiers. We'll reinforce them biologically. It's a very Cronenberg kind of thing.
Oh, body horror.
Yep.
The brand is steeped in mega violence, suffering, and institutional ignorance.
Oh, where?
Have I not made this clear? The galaxy is not a nice place to live.
No.
You don't like it, don't play, jackass.
Mm-hmm.
He goes, but there's still hope. If they're thinking about a late night cartoon, none of this matters. A 40K show would fit perfectly alongside Rick and Morty. That's what you bring up?
What?
No!
What?
Twitch.
Oh, here we go.
And the Venture Brothers. Okay, I like the Venture Brothers, so I'll give that. Especially if they embrace its insane roots. But if they're shooting for a mainstream action cartoon or anything live action, they have some serious retconning to do. No, they do.
No. Oh, God damn it.
Yo, kill me with this. I can't help but hear him.
Robert.
Y'all trying to kill me. You know, this is what this, you know, an NPC Soylent trying to understand 40K, it's like me trying to understand Twilight.
Yeah.
Good luck with
that.
What
the fuck?
I understand both, and one I hate, the other I don't. Take a guess which one it is.
Sparkly vampires? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and he goes, or GW could embrace the dumbness of the setting if the Emperor had a text-to-speech device turning the sheer stupidity of the setting into the joke.
I think I know where they're going with this one. You remember that show, That's My Bush?
I never saw that.
Yeah. They're basically suggesting it used this as sort of a parody of Trump. And like, what? Well, you're gonna use the 40K. You're gonna use a 40K franchise to try to take a go at Trump.
Except here's the problem. What if you're writing a story that Big E isn't involved in?
Yeah.
So what? What for instance, if you were writing about the time when a splinter of a Hive fleet decided to fight the Tau?
Oh.
Or,
well, no one of these woke assholes, they'd find some way to shoehorn the God Emperor into it because, again.
Mm-hmm.
They're goddamn TDS.
Yeah, the or for that matter, if you're covering something like the Badab War, which had nothing to do with Big E or any of the stuff with Honso. You go.
And well, like I said, they could create the or like I said, sorry, they could create their own straw man.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He goes on to say, then again, the Emperor calls Gilman a fag in the first episode. Maybe 40K is irredeemable.
No, maybe you're just an idiot.
No, yeah.
I wonder if they got butthurt because their favorite chapter is the Ultra Smurfs.
and doesn't
quite realize why everybody hates the Ultramarines.
Mm-hmm.
Then he goes, what's interesting is that 40K's equally bloody and satanic fantasy version, Age of Sigmar. Age of Sigmar and 40K are completely divorced from each other. Don't even start with me with this.
Yeah, fucking. This is the thing with new fans. They don't read the fucking between the lines. I mean, what do you do? Do you go on Wikipedia for 5 minutes and just look this shit up and say, hey, I got a fucking shit piece to write. Yay!
Yeah.
It's probably because it doesn't have the same stigma. Well, Age of Sigmar has only been out for about 4 years.
Mm-hmm.
And it has other stigmas, namely coming after the whole End Times debacle that nobody liked.
Yeah.
By the way, fuck the End Times.
Mm-hmm.
It's probably because 40K is supposed to be the future. That's never outright stated.
No. Yeah, it's an unknown time. For all you know, it could be like 40,000 years in the past.
There's a reason why it's in the same vein as why Star Wars opens up with a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. That's basically a spin on the long ago in a land far away thing that you would see in fairy tales when we were kids.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And it paints the future as a nightmare in which every bad thing humanity ever did is entrenched and institutionalized, as if the worst instincts of humanity are not only acceptable, but inevitable. It's basically the anti-Star Trek. Do not bring Star Trek into this, because you don't understand that franchise either.
Don't! If you can't do Star Trek well, don't!
And I want to point something out here. Some of his other articles are a primer on the God Emperor for non-trolls. You don't even know what a troll is, so don't even start with me on that. And how to annoy gamers that deify Trump. No gamer does that.
Oh, for God's sakes.
No.
Here we go.
People post memes. This is the reason why phrase, the left can't meme, will continue to be a thing. And
Yeah, gather around, kids. I see the train coming.
All aboard!
Oh my God!
Okay, this Oscar guy is apparently an editor for some place called We Will Be Game. There Will Be Games. Never heard of it. And
it's probably
garbage. He somehow has less followers than me. And let me... Let's take a look at his
Damn!
Yeah, I'm looking at his Twitter. Liquor? I'm looking at his Twitter right now. He only has 807 followers.
Into the trash it goes.
Yeah.
But it gets better because let's look at some of his articles so we can see what we're dealing with. The Dark Art of Remixing Board Games.
Remixing?
Yeah,
their word for wokeifying them.
Confessions of an ex-fortune teller. Just enough nerd culture and okay, now we throw him into the trash. No.
Yeah.
We throw him in Detroit.
Yes!
Yes!
Send him to Detroit!
No! No, not Detroit! No! No, please! Everything with that!
No. Oh, boy, I cannot wait until I get Ronan out there. Woo-wee! I am going to have fun with these motherfuckers.
Yep.
Oh, yeah.
Impeach the motherfuckers. So we've got a bit of TDS. Rule books are meant to be broken.
Yeah, not the way you think, idiot.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see. The dark art of politicizing board games and 7 political board games for election junkies. Rysis is the best RPG system for Star Wars? Are you fucking...
What?
What?
Damn it. I thought we banished him to Detroit. Oh, wait, apparently he's still spewing out the garbage.
Bathroom.
Clearly. Yeah.
Put him in a fucking bathroom. Get him out of here. Come on.
A bathroom in Detroit.
And apparently he got offended by Farmer of Racism when there was that infamous fuck up with Titan Forge. Not Titan Forge, but Key Forge.
God damn it, the train's derailed again.
All aboard!
Oh my god.
Do you guys remember the bit of infamy with Keyforge with some of the randomly generated names that we found that we were laughing our ass off.
Yeah. Yep.
One of the more infamous ones was Titan Flare, the Farmer of Racism. General Bone Rider Colt. Raising. She Who Punches Sympathy. Wang the Suddenly Bruised.
Oh,
Emancipate
God.
The Antagonizer of Boys. The Boy Who Plows for the Empress. Raising.
Yes.
The Boy Who Basically Headbutts Heaven. But Simone's not even here.
Oh boy.
And Tomb Dirk, the Teacher of Socialism.
Fridge, large meat.
Punt, speed chunk.
Butch, deadlift. Bold, big flank.
Splint, chest hair. Flint, iron stag.
Bolt, Vander Huge.
Thick McRunfat.
We put our faith in blast hard cheese.
Buff. Drink lots.
Bunk, slam chest.
Fist, rock bone.
Stump, beef knob.
Smash, slap jaw.
But
anyway,
bottom line when it comes to that particular piece, what he effectively wants is to make it in quote unquote Hollywood, whether it be big or small screen or whatever, and we don't even know what this whole multimedia projects are going to entail.
Yeah, this is current. Yeah, they're trying to current year modify this shit.
Yeah, so,
get them out of here.
If you expect to do that and not get some blowback from 40K's fan base, please give me the optimistic drugs you are on.
That's stupid. Use your common sense.
Seriously, you're dealing with one of the more hardcore fan bases, and you expected them to not blow you the fuck out.
Yeah.
And this I see be, that Gabe fan like brings that. Up. Give the Emperor his text-to-speech device. He probably has something to say.
Yeah.
Yeah, this would be like putting... doing this shit to 40K would be like putting Jim Hurd in charge of WCW.
Oh, God.
Well, they probably say that the Ding Dongs are trans and therefore progressive. But
anyway,
that is gonna do it for us tonight on this iteration of Monastery Live. I am still trying to figure out what the hell is going on with my soundboard, and. In the meantime, Monastery Gaming will return tomorrow. What game in question? Well, that's gonna be a surprise. However, there will not be Monastery Gaming on Tuesday because I am hosting a watch party, and it is going to be of a certain film, a certain film that is. Appropriate. And if you're smart, you'll already know what it is, but I implore you not to say it.
Is it what I think it is?
DM me what you think it is.
I know exactly what it is.
So that'll even I know the drama related to the film, but it is my tradition. And to further that in the furtherance of traditions, I will say this. On July 4th, I will be doing a similar watch party. Now, most people, when they think of a patriotic film to watch on July 4th, they'll think of, say, Patriot or Independence Day. That's not what I'm going with.
No.
I am going with the most patriotic musical you can find.
Yes.
And the whole of us will say, "Sit down, John."
Yes.
But
anyway,
another thing. This Friday, I will be hosting an interview with with Broken Dice, the developers of the Nuandan Chronicles.
Hmm.
We had arranged this for last week, but. There was a bit of a crunch. I double booked. I asked if we could delay it a week. They were gonna do it this Thursday, but they're doing a playtest session that day, so we moved it to Friday. Plus,
right.
Doing an interview on Halloween didn't feel quite right, especially since they were gonna be handing out candy. I am in negotiation with a couple other people to try and bring them in for an interview. If I can get Kit Sanchia to come on, I would love to talk with him about some of his books. But that's a story for another time. Right now it's just a case of I'm playing a fair bit of phone tag. Almost like I'm deluding myself into thinking I'm some kind of big deal. But. Oh, what?
Oh, Virtue Signal, the game, they put a new, hold on, I'll link it to the council, hold on.
Wait, is this?
Damn it. Of course, Facebook's fucking up.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but anyway, it's basically, okay, the microaggression is this. Culturally sensitive blackface. Your wish is granted. Long live Justin.
Oh, yeah.
I'm trying to find some of the one star reviews that he got with his game.
Anyway.
But I will say. I will say, of course, that next week we will, of course, be returning with Monastery Live. Saturday, if all goes as planned, I will have a review up for Numenera Discovery.
Ah.
And if a certain person happens to be watching this, keep it in your damn pants, Varric. But until next we meet, on behalf of the good brothers present and not present, and on the good behalf of us mourning the death of a part of Doku's liquor cabinet, my name is Mildra. I am your gaming monk. Stay fucking frosty, and Epstein didn't kill